Welcome everyone to the 12th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received no apologies for today's meeting from any member. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed? Yes. Agreed. Thank you, colleagues. And our second item today is two evidence sessions as part of our inquiry into alternative pathways into primary care. And our first panel will focus on social prescribing, the Link Worker Programme and the role of the third sector. And I'm delighted to welcome our panellists this morning. We've got Claire Cook, the Regional Manager and Co-Chair of the Scottish Social Prescribing Network. We've got Alison Leach, Community Link Worker Area Lead and Co-Chair of the Scottish Social Prescribing Network. Roseanne Logan, the Links Programme Manager for the Health and Social Care Alliance. And Christiana Mellum, the Chief Executive Officer for the National Association of Link Workers. Welcome to you all. I'll go round you all really to start off in terms of the, if you think there's a wider, there's a potential for wider use of social prescribing in Scotland than there is now, and how we can find a better balance between the medical and the social approaches to healthcare more generally. So if I just go around you in the order in which I introduced you, I'll take Claire first.
Morning, everyone. So yes, I absolutely think there is a place for social prescribing in Scotland. I'll just tell you very briefly about Spring Social Prescribing because that will influence my answer going forward. So Spring Social Prescribing is funded by the National Lottery Community Fund, and we help address adults supporting them with their social, emotional and practical needs to improve their health and wellbeing, and we do that by connecting them to community support. So we are based in 8 community-led health organisations in Scotland, so it is a different model to the Community Link Worker Programme. But we work very well with the Community Link Worker Programme, so what I would say is that not one size fits all. So I would say to recognise that there are lots of different models in Scotland and lots of experience and professional organisations that run them throughout the country.
Thanks. And can I come to Alison Leach?
Hi, thank you. As Claire said, I absolutely believe that social prescribing should be used on a wider basis. The Edinburgh Link Worker Programme is part of the Scottish Government-funded programme that was the 2016 election manifesto. So the setup that we have in Edinburgh is that the link workers are employed in third sector organisations in their localities, 4 localities across Edinburgh. But at the moment we have 21 link workers covering 43 GP practices, and they're employed by 11 different third sector organisations across the city. We've got 21 GP practices as part of the national programme focusing on health inequalities, and those practices have at least 20% of their patient population classed as deprived. And then we have 22 practices that are covered by Primary Care Improvement Plan money, and that's where we see our growth. Those GPs see the benefits that those practices in the health inequalities funded programme, they see the benefits that they bring. So it's really great to see that other practices are coming on board with the Link Worker programme and seeing the link workers as part of their multidisciplinary team. I think Claire hit the nail on the head. There's so many different models across Scotland, and as part of our social prescribing network, that's what we are trying to map and have an overall structure to this. And also I'm part of the working group on the Scottish Community Link Worker Network that's recently been set up, and that's trying to gather the information of the different programmes. Not one size fits all at all, but to try and have some overarching picture of what link worker and social prescribing looks within Scotland.
And I'll pick up on something that you said there, which I'm interested in. You said that GPs are already seeing the benefits of this. Could you expand on that? What are they seeing as a benefit?
Well, a lot of the GPs are realising they're not always the best person to service the needs of that patient. You know, we all are very well aware of the pressures on primary care at the moment, And when you've only got a 5, 7, 10 minute appointment, you're not going to get to the root of the problems, the social problems that the patients are bringing. When a link worker can spend an hour with somebody, can address housing issues, benefit issues, employment issues, those are the things that the GPs can't deal with. So then if they've got a link worker dealing with that, even if the patient still continues to attend the practice, then the GP is getting better use of their time because all those social issues are taken out of the consulting time and they can address the health issues directly.
Thank you. That's helpful. Can I come to Roseanne next?
Good morning. Hi, I'm Roseanne and I'm the programme manager with the Alliance. So agree with both my colleagues that have been on already around the wider use of social prescribing. With the Alliance, we ran a pilot programme in 2014 in Glasgow, which was in collaboration with DPN GPs. That started out with 7 DPN GPs. We are now sitting in Glasgow in 53 GP practices, which are all DPN'd. We also have a model within Western Bartonshire, which is going to be quite different. And again, as Claire alluded to, different models are really important across Scotland. Because we have different dynamics across this country, so we need to be able to embrace that. I think as well, getting the balance of the medical model and social model is really important. And as Alison was alluding to there, for GPs and for other healthcare professionals, they're limited in the time and the scope that they have with patients. They don't tend to know a lot what's going on within their communities, and that's where links workers especially are really valuable. Coming from third sector, voluntary sector backgrounds, they know their communities, they link in with their communities, they know what's available, they know the importance of building relationships within their communities, so they're best placed then to support patients with aspects of social issues that are impacting on their lives. So I think that it's really important that as we move forward, that we have the SSPN, we have the NALW, because we need to be looking at our workforce, very varied across the country, but we need to be having the opportunity to be bringing them together to collaborate and to be looking at sharing learning as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Rosanna. And you have hit upon something about, you know, there's the patchiness of provision across the country. And you're alluding to the fact that maybe that best practice isn't really been shared at the moment. Would that be fair to say that there's potential for more knowledge sharing on the benefits of it?
Yes, definitely, convener. And I think that's why it's really great that we have the SSPN. I sit on the steering group with the SSPN and I also sit on the advisory panel with the NALW, because I see there is real value for us to be sharing the knowledge, to be looking to see what there is across the country. And both these organisations and setups, they're having that opportunity to do that, to bring together people from not just third sector, but also some HSCPs are employing links workers, some health boards are employing links workers. But we want to be bringing these different models together to be sharing the best practice, because ultimately that's what we want. It's the patients, it's the people of Scotland that we want to ensure that we've been able to deliver the right service for these individuals in their communities.
Thank you, that's helpful. Thank you. And can I come to Christiana Mellum?
Hello everybody, lovely to be here giving evidence with colleagues. So NALW, like Roseanne kind of like alluded to, we're more focused on the workforce. So we are a professional body for social prescribing link workers in the UK. And as I'm going to be sharing experience and learning from our members in Scotland, and also some of them, well, they are all members of this panel as well. And the roundtable discussion that we had to inform what I would say at this meeting. So first of all, can I just pay tribute to the social prescribing programs in Scotland that has won lots of awards. So we do run an annual awards and we do have representative of those award winners in this panel. So the first social prescribing link worker of the year was won by Sean, who is part of Claire's Springs social prescribing program. And we have the community group of the year award that was won by YAP, which is a community project run by the Alliance. We've got Roseanne, who has been highly commended manager of the year for social prescribing. We've also had North Ayrshire Community Link Worker Programme, the Edinburgh Health and Social Care Partnership, all have been finalists and been highly commended for their social prescribing efforts. So there's lots of experience and knowledge to really share. So at NLW, we think it's time to mainstream social prescribing because general practice is at risk of becoming a crisis service. So everybody is chasing the symptoms or treating the symptoms. And if we're not going to intervene in the vulnerabilities and get to the root cause, then we have a healthcare system that is all about illness. So yes, we know about the impact of the social and economic and environmental factors that affect our health. So therefore, it doesn't make sense to separate both. But the challenge has been we've not got a mechanism by which we can mainstream this in the NHS until the introduction of social prescribing. And what they have been able to do, particularly in general practice, is about that whole person medicine. What is the difference between general practice and specialist services? It's because of the whole person. It's because of the continuity of care. It's because of the prevention. It's because we're asking people, how are they? So with the pandemic, lots of people are not asking people, how are you? And this is a very big problem because people need to be listened to. Listening itself is a treatment. As one of the patients that have been supported by social prescribing says, a listening ear is worth $1 million. So it is very important that we have a mechanism by which people feel listened to. We have a mechanism by which we're actually empowering people. This is definitely about social justice and it's about inequalities. It's about recognizing that the way people feel within their community, the way they feel, whether they are integrated within their community, has an impact. Because if they don't have anywhere to go to, they know that the NHS won't turn their back on them. So it's not about preventing people from coming. It's about when they appear, when they are at your door, what supports do you have available for them? Do you have the social prescribing opportunities for them? Are you supporting the link workers? How are you also encouraging social mobility? Because the people that become social prescribing link workers themselves got to leave their spirits. People want to help. There's a lot of opportunities for people to help them. Social prescribing is the bridge between the community and the NHS, which then means they have a lot of information and knowledge to share to policymakers to actually say what is going on for people because they have the time to spend longer with them and build up that trusting relationship, which then is transformational. There are lots of people for 20, 30 years have not had anyone listen to them with the depth that the social prescribing link workers have got and with no agenda. So in itself, it's transformation. You then see communities that are thriving, that are transforming, that are wanting to help. This is the way we reduce pressure on the NHS. It's about the impact infrastructure that is around the person. What is the incentive for the person to look after their health? What is the incentive to go for the walk? If they're not able to go for the walk, who is removing those barriers? Somebody has to take responsibility to enable and empower people to take control of their narrative.
Thank you, Christiana. And I really like what you said there about the whole person approach. And it strikes me when I'm listening to you is that one of the things that obviously us as elected representatives, as somebody who have people coming to us in crisis, is I often worry about the people who don't come and see me, but everybody goes to their GP surgery and that's bringing services to where people are. Would you agree that that is important? These hard to reach people who will need help, it's important that we move services to be where they are.
Yeah, so absolutely. And as colleagues have said, social prescribing is not a one size fits all. So we say any place where there are human beings and you want to reduce health inequalities and you want to reduce social injustice, you need to consider social prescribing. So it's not just health, it's something that is cross-cutting as well. So general practice in itself, by being a community asset, is the glue that connects to other services and professionals, rather than being seen as the focal point on which the patient is dependent on the particular GP. There are community-based social prescribing programs as well. That this community-based social prescribing project as well means that, you know, people that don't access the GP practice or communities that are marginalized can also get support. So the interest really for us is how do we get that integration where community-based social prescribing services that are not based within the GP practice, those that are based within the GP practice, What is that interface? And surely social prescribing link workers can be that glue between those as well. So it's more of how do we integrate, have an integrated approach that enables continuity of care, that means the person is not repeating themselves, that then empowers clinician with a full picture of what is going on, if the person is supported in the community or general practice, then the medical diagnosis or the whole picture perspective is really clear and also helps inform treatment.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you to all. I know that Claire and Alison want to come back in, and I will bring you back in, but I do have a supplementary question from Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. And this is Christina. I'd like to just address something that you said there about when anywhere there's a human, paraphrasing you, but anywhere there's a human being, we sort of need that listening ear, we need the help, we need to be holistic. What are we doing in terms of helping people who might be coming across from Ukraine as far as link working is concerned? Because I think the social prescribing aspect is going to be key here.
So the social prescribing programs obviously is tailored to model, isn't it? Funding mechanisms and who their services might be for. So some have got that level of flexibility based on the model. There are also social prescribing link workers in Scotland that are specialists and focus on refugee and asylum seekers. You've got migrants groups as well. So what the social prescribing movement has identified is where there are specific cohorts that needs proactive intervention and support. You can actually have social prescribing link workers that are focusing on those. Then you also have some that are in general practice where it depends on the culture. And if the general practice is focused on those that are just on their list, then the social prescribing link worker will be focused on those that are on the list. If it's a community-based social prescribing program or it is a social prescribing service in the GP surgery that is open to those sort of like intervention that's about the community and opens up its doors to the community, then the social prescribing link workers can support them. So there is no, in some programs, there is no closed list. They support everybody that needs to have support. The challenge is then that the social prescribing link worker is only as good as what we've got in the community. And they also have information on some of the social and structural inequalities that is driving those. They can only help the person to reduce or remove some of those barriers and inequalities based on the services that are available. But then when they identify these blocks, how do they feed that back to systems, to policymakers, to understand what is actually getting in the way? It's one of the aspects of the social prescribing link workers' role that has not been tapped into, is the information that they've got to actually shape policy.
Thank you. Can I bring Claire Cook back in? Claire.
Thank you. I just wanted to touch upon the hardest to reach people in our community. So the benefit for Spring Social Prescribing and Alison's programme is the same as that. Our social prescribers are hosted within community-led health organisations. So they know the communities really well. They know where the hardest to reach people are. So these are people that traditionally might not approach their GP for certain different things. So for us, meeting with a social prescriber in the community, it almost normalises this engagement and it encourages participation as well. And just quickly, I wanted to say about support for Ukraine. That's something that we would definitely be doing. I know we're going to be discussing about opening up referral routes, but post-pandemic, we changed our referral routes. So previous to that, we were accepting referrals from GPs and primary care only. But as people weren't attending these different professionals for the right reasons, then we had to change our referral routes. So we now open to a whole range of different places and organisations, such as pharmacists, the Community Link Worker Programme refers to us, housing associations, carer centres. So I would imagine that anyone from Ukraine would get that support, absolutely. They don't need to be part of a GP practice. They would get support within these community-led health organisations. Thanks.
Thanks. And can I bring Alison Leach back in?
Thanks. Just following up from what Claire said there, our statistics show that GPs see 70% of the population over the period of a year. So they're the ideal place for people to have the knowledge of what happens in the community and the third sector. And as Claire said, our link workers are embedded across the four localities. They're employed by locality-led third sector organisations that know their communities, they know the needs that the public public face, so that they bring that knowledge. We've got GP leads sitting on our programme as kind of the experts, so they're fully aware of what's happening in the third sector. And I think building those bridges between primary care and the third sector is essential, whether it's getting GPs involved in funding decisions, or we've got a trust fund in Edinburgh where it's primary care and third sector organisations, and we've had a few successful grant applications for that. We've had third sector organisation host PLTs, really just getting that knowledge shared so that when somebody does come to the reception or somebody does answer the phone, that everybody knows their organisations that are on their doorstep. And to follow up just on the Ukraine, Edinburgh doesn't have a huge amount of asylum seekers, but we have certainly anybody that's registered to a GP practice that holds that status. We work with them. We've got a unique link worker that works with the homeless practice. I think that's only one in Scotland. And I think what the pandemic has shown as well is we completely changed the way that we worked when that hit 2 years ago. We became very responsive because the third sector has that flexibility to change immediately overnight. We changed from delivering food parcels to prescriptions. We opened up the whole service to every practice in Edinburgh. We helped with the government signposting helpline, the local Edinburgh Council one as well. So we have that ability when there's a need in the wider general public. Link workers and third sector organisations can shift with that need. But I think what it also highlights, and Claire and I have had this conversation with Niall Taylor, who sits under Marie Todd's team, and we've had it through the Scottish Community Link Worker Network, that where Scotland falls down, sadly, is there's nobody taking charge of social prescribing in Scotland. In Edinburgh, in England, we have a head of social prescribing within the NHS. In Wales, it's through public health. And I know Niall Taylor and Katie and his team, they've been having discussions with England and Wales. And then you've got the joint network, the All-Ireland network as well, because they are aware, because it does follow two of the ministers' portfolios. But really, we know what happens at the grassroots, and we know that the Scottish Government have it within their strategies and policies, but there's this gap of knowledge, of feeding back, because we all want these strategies and policies to work, but we also want our programmes to work. And we need the evaluation to come back up, because we know that there's going to be increasing pressure on state money. So we need to prove, we need to show you the good work that we can do, and we can show the difference, evidence, everything, so that if there's GPs that are maybe a wee bit doubtful, we've got that evidence base that gets fed back up into the government, and that is shared. And as we touched on earlier, sharing the best practice, there's new link worker programmes coming on board, or new social prescribes. Let's not reinvent the wheel. We've all been cutting our teeth on this for a few years now. You know, there's different things coming on board. The Edinburgh Health and Social Care Partnership have just made a huge investment into taking on board Elemental, which is a social prescribing management tool that talks to the GP vision systems. Now, the evaluation opportunities that give us is huge. West Lothian, I think they're also on board with it. Highland are taking it on. But, you know, possibly that's maybe something we could look at more on a national scale, so that we're all getting the evaluation that's proven, that proves that what we do is worthwhile and meaningful, and then is worth future investment.
Thank you, Alison. That was very helpful information, and I can see a lot of people making notes about questions that we might want to put to the government on this, so thank you. I think Rosanne wants to come back in, and then I'm going to move on to questions about public perception from Emma Harper. So, Rosanne.
Yes, thank you. Just going back to linking primary care with third sector, I think it's really important. A lot of GPs don't know a lot of what's going on within their local communities. So one of the initiatives that we had been carrying out before the pandemic, especially in health centres across Glasgow, was around bringing the community to you. And what we would do is links workers would link in with third sector and statutory sector services like Smoking Cessation, Macmillan Transforming Cancer Journey, and invite them into the health centres or the GP practices once a week. They would set up their stall, so they would get to meet the patients that were coming through the practice. But the links workers would also encourage the GPs and the practice nurse to come out at their tea breaks and come and meet these services, so they know exactly who's in the communities. And I think it's really important that we continue to forge these relationships between our primary care and community services. One of the other big issues that we have found, and I'm sure that this will be no surprise, is around space within primary care. It's at a premium. We're having new health centres being built, but still there's lack of space, especially when we move forward with our multidisciplinary teams. We're bringing in pharmacy into primary care. We're bringing in MSK physios. We're bringing in welfare rights officers. We've also then got our links workers. Where are we housing all these individuals? Where are they going to be? So we need to be looking at community space. Yes, it's really important for a links worker that they're visible within their practice so that they're not forgotten about for receiving referrals. But for them to see people, a lot of times it's important for them to make links out in their community. Now, that can be with the local housing association and asking to use one of their community rooms. It can be looking at other community venues, other libraries. I think as Claire was saying, you know, it's important that we look at where there are other spaces in our communities and look at utilising these, because for some individuals that will be comfortable for them as well. It is very much a person-centred approach, and for some people coming into the GP practice, there is that place of trust for individuals. But also for some people, meeting out in the community could be a really valuable resource that we've got. And just for the last point that was made just around about Ukraine and the situation there, we're already within Glasgow, especially, again, no surprise, there's a large percentage of asylum seeker refugees across the city. We're based in Govan Hill in Glasgow in three practices where we've got the largest Roma community for the whole of Scotland. Well, we're used to working with local community groups and networks and really building relationships with these organisations, looking at how we can link in interpreter services. That, again, can be a challenge. We need to ensure that as a nation we're equipped then, if we're going to be taking an abundance of individuals coming from Ukraine, that we have interpreter services to ensure that we can work closely with individuals where English may not be their first language. We need to ensure, as we did during the pandemic, that resources are made available in languages so that they're easily read for individuals, so that they know how they can access their GP practice. Because for a lot of people just now, contacting the GP practice, when they phone up, the response they receive is in English. If English isn't your first language, how are you going to get through that initial barrier of even contacting your GP practice? So we need to be mindful of these things as we move forward, just around how we can remove all barriers and access for everyone that's going to be living or coming to Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll move on to questions from Emma Harper. Emma.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, everybody. I'm interested in what the public know about social prescribing, because there are a few papers out there that say it's been around for years, but then we've started having more dialogue about it, and we know the value of social prescribing, especially during the initial lockdown in the pandemic. Especially, we know, for like mental health and social isolation and befriending, there's two particular projects that I know of locally in Dumfries and Galloway. One is actually called Listening Ear in Stranraer, and the other one is by the D&G Third Sector. So I'm interested in what your understanding is of the public's knowledge of social prescribing and as a pathway for treatment, so not just for men's sheds or mental health, but what do the public understand about it?
Who would you like to go to first, Emma?
Alison.
Thank you. Our programme, we don't take self-referrals. It has to come from somebody within the practice team, and that decision was made because of risk. So somebody in the practice team has to be aware if they are in risk, because we've actually had a couple of near misses with patients being in a room with link workers that shouldn't be. And we also have an obligation for assessing risk when we're referring people onto community organisations. So we don't have posters or leaflets in practices, but we rely on the GPs. It's all about that trust and relationship. You know, I think it was touched on earlier that people will come to their MSPs about issues, but almost GPs are put on such a pedestal that people trust them so much. So it's around GPs educating their patients into the other services, the alternative pathways that are available within the practice. Now, whether that's a physio or a pharmacist or a link worker, But what I found, especially when I had a caseload in a practice, is that when a GP has a discussion around, well, look, let's look at alternatives, because I'm not the best person to help you, but I have a link worker here. And the person trusts the GP that they agree to then come and see the link worker. And again, we have a kind of handbook guide for our link workers that we say you should work with a person for between 4 to 6 sessions. Now, that's not set in stone, but it's to set expectations out at the beginning that we're not support workers and this is not an endless service, but there are boundaries around that. So you're setting the expectations up quite early. And then because you get to spend that time, you know, if you've got an hour to spend getting to know somebody in that first initial appointment, then you start building trust from there. So that then when you do come to the second or third appointment and you start suggesting support services or group activities, then you've got that buy-in from the patient. So it's maybe not about the public awareness, but it's once they are in that consultation room with the GP that this kind of trusting educational process begins, that it's not that a GP is not always the best person. And you see that varies through generations. Our practices have a lot of training doctors, and those doctors just get it right away. So when they start suggesting these things to their patients, it just seems to work. And you see that trust and relationship move from the GP to the link worker to then to the community organisation. And that's the best outcomes that you can hope for.
Emma? You probably have mentioned to other panellists, if you want to come in anything, use the chat box, let me know if you want to come in. And Christiana does. Thank you, Christiana. Over to you.
Thank you. So I think that's a great question. And the thing is that with social prescribing, it's about social change. So it's not something that, you know, we can rush. So there needs to be a national campaign. And I suppose that the challenge with that in Scotland is that the access is not universal. So some areas, there is no social prescribing link worker there in the first place, which I wonder if that is what it's, when you're introducing change, you need to make sure you have a mechanism to also communicate that. And that is something that is lacking, where it's just left to the individual social prescribing programs to do that. You need education across the board because you're introducing a social change. And as you know, some of the GP colleagues would say, is that this is the biggest cultural shift in healthcare and medicine. So it's not just, it's quite a huge change where even the training for clinicians and the way they see things needs to change. Yeah, VCSE organizations that might have been doing some elements of social prescribing in terms of the social prescribing activities, well, they now need to understand the philosophy of this and that if it's mainstreamed, there is an expectation from the patient to, there is a level of expectation if they feel it's actually something that is mainstream. And that's one of the things that we are concerned with, is while social prescribing is based on local needs and local tailoring, we still need to have some level of consistency. We don't want somebody meeting a link worker in a particular area, and then there is a risk there. If you see a GP, you see a GP. If you see a clinician, and I did read some of the views from the survey, and you can see. So how do we give people the trust that they need? And this is what NALW is trying to do. We've got a code of practice, which our members sign up for. It's all voluntary. We've got a CPD framework, and we're beginning to have conversations with NHS Education for Scotland. But it'd be something that the panel helps to, encourage them to take ownership, because across other nations, it is their education as arm's length body statutory that is overseeing that. So the training and the education needs of these link workers is not being catered for enough. We need to have a comprehensive framework for Scotland. You've got that. Wales, they're designing theirs. England has just done theirs as well. So it's very important that we make sure that there is no postcode lottery, that there is a baseline of what you expect. We did our survey we did last year. What it highlighted was the biggest challenges that our members face is a lack of understanding of their role and role boundary. So it's UK-wide, this is a problem. And it is something we need to address, and we need to specify and get some standards and basic understanding of what this person does. Interestingly, we are doing a an engagement work with the National Association for Patient Participation. I did love what one of the chairs from one of the PPGs actually said. So we're trying to explore their understanding. And that survey, the report's not yet published. I think it probably published before May. I'm happy to share that. And it's quite really surprising in terms of how the patients we are describing social prescribing. Some of them said, well, I used to compile lists of all the singing groups, all the working groups in my area, even before we now have a link worker, in our area. So there is an understanding in terms of the activities or what those people might be. And some of them were actually describing what they felt they meant. And we were saying, oh, maybe that should be the new description we should use. So don't underestimate the fact that, some of the patients, they quite really understand and appreciate it because they feel that's what they've been doing. Patient participation group is a community group. So that is one of the groups that you would connect somebody to. And they have been, listening to and supporting their members. The concern that we have is, how are we sustaining these groups? How are we sustaining these groups? These groups are reliant mostly on volunteers. How are we helping them to be sustainable? And if the social prescribing link workers work is very narrow focused and a bit medicalized, we forget that this is about community asset. This is about what are the gaps for setting up new groups, community integration. It then means that if you're feeling lonely or you're feeling a little bit down or you just need to get somewhere, you're just kind of like neighborhood. Everyone knows everybody because it's about the social prescribing workforce. It's not just the link workers. It is also the community and all the assets around them. So there's a lot of goodwill there. And it's not just patients asking for appointments. They are also part of the social prescribing workforce and wanting to help. Some of the PPGs are no longer in existence now. Some of the community groups no longer in existence because we've had COVID and people, are fearful. So what is the remobilization plan that we have to rebuild communities? What is the remobilization plan that we have for PPGs? In terms of raising awareness, it's something we all have to collectively do. It is a social responsibility that we have. This is about social justice and reversing the inverse care law. So it's not just us in this group. It's something the Scottish government can do to make sure that as an anchor organization, it helps to stream that. But it's something that everybody needs to raise that awareness, from patients to clinicians to VCSC to businesses and everybody that is interested in reducing inequalities and social injustice. Mm-hmm.
Thanks. I want to bring in Claire and Roseanne and Alison again. I know you want to come back in, but I'm going to go back to Emma because she has a supplementary question to throw into the mix. Mm-hmm. So if I go back to Emma first, and then we'll go to Claire first of all.
Okay, thanks. Great. Yeah, it's kind of on the basis of what Alison said and Christiana as well, that I'm interested in what the barriers are for people to pick up a social prescribing pathway. Like Alison talked about, people seeing the GP first and then they've got one or two or three further visits in order to get them enticed into maybe joining a walking group or visiting a men's shed or participating in Listening Ear, for instance. And I know that we've seen with the community empowerment legislation that community hubs are being created. Community asset transfer has enabled communities to get together and create community hubs and community centres and feel empowered. And that's also been helping. But basically, what are the barriers to somebody saying, OK, I will do this, instead of seeing the GP again or again or again? What is that particular thing that stops people progressing?
I'll bring in Claire.
Thanks. Just to touch upon the public's perception of social prescribing, I don't think social prescribing is widely used in public. I don't think that's the language. I would agree that a lot of the organisations I support, certainly, they have been doing this for a long time. So it's almost about the terminology that's new, I would say. Like Alison's programme and the Alliance as well, we need to take referrals, and it is to mitigate that risk from self-referrals. However, in terms of the barrier for the organisations I support, Spring Social Prescribing is only one element to what they do. So I know that because these organisations are based in their local communities, anyone can walk in off that street and go to that organisation and say, I need a bit of support. It might not be through spring social prescribing that they can get that support, but it might be through some of the other programmes that are held within those organisations. So there are barriers, but there's certainly ways to get around about those barriers where people can pick up the phone or access third sector organisations. But these organisations are only as best as the funding that they have. And I think that's obviously a big barrier, it's about funding for these organisations that are in existence.
Thank you. And can I bring in Roseanne?
Thank you. Around what the public knows, I do think it's really variable. I think that if a GP practice has a links worker, then maybe not all of the practice population will know that there's a links worker based in that practice. Our Glasgow programme does take self-referrals, and that was something early on in discussion with our GP partners around that. And we've found that there's an increase in self-referrals now. People will talk about the service they've received and tell their friends, tell their colleagues, and so people will come and self-refer. We also have leaflets that, you know, information about a links worker, what it is that they'll do. It talks about some of the social prescribing, some of the areas that they can support people with, whether it be around housing, bereavement, benefits, etc. But also, I think what's really important is the use of medical records, because our links workers can access medical records. So just like anyone else in the practice team, they'll see if there's any alerts for any patients. So if someone's making a self-referral, they'll do that through the receptionist. So the receptionist will be able to see if there's an alert. And if that's the case, then they would assess the risk and they would look at maybe having a joint visit in the practice for an individual, just the same way the practice nurse would. Because with our programme, there is no exclusion criteria, similar to the GP practice has no exclusion criteria. Anyone on the practice list can come along and see any of the health professionals within there. Talking about some of the barriers for individuals accessing services. For many people, and especially with our Glasgow programme, which is based within Deep End GP practices, so some of the areas that we're working within, people aren't ready to engage. And this was even before the pandemic, people weren't ready to engage. So the links worker has that opportunity to build that trust, to have that conversation with someone. We're not time limited either. So although we capture how many sessions people will have, it can vary from one session to people actually working with a links worker for months, because it may be they're trying to access or navigate either a statutory mental health or social care service. But one of the other things as well is just around individuals' lack of confidence, lack of self-worth. And so when we've got anecdotal evidence of individuals being spoken and told about services within the community, and one is a young mum who had a young family and was socially isolated. She didn't know anyone else in the area. The links worker spoke about a bounce and rhyme class that was going on in the local library, and that young mum didn't feel that that was for her, because she said she would feel out of place, because as she put it, no, that's the yummy mummies. That's mums that are on maternity leave. I wouldn't have any conversation. I wouldn't know how to speak to them. So that barrier was overcome by the links worker saying, do you want me to come with you? Would that help if I came along to that class with you? And so the links worker done that and supported that young mum to access that service with her baby. She went twice until that young mum then realised her perception of what that group was very different to how she had seen it previously. But she was able to then access that. And I think that's really important, because it's not just around signposting or referring people to services, but it's been able to walk alongside someone to look at it in an individual, a person-centred way, and look to see, you know, asking the person, what matters to you? What is going to be the difficulty or the barrier? Is it walking through the door of that women's centre? Is it walking through the door of the men's shed? Then I'll come with you if that would help, and I will walk alongside you with that journey. And I think that's really important that that's captured as well, that there's much more to social prescribing. And that's where we need to look at all the different models that we have across the country. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Alison?
Thanks. It was just to go back to about the public awareness. There's the Scottish Government advert that's out just now about the receptionist. You know, when somebody phones the receptionist and she can redirect you to whether it's an optician or whether you need to go to pharmacy. I don't think social prescribing is part of that advert, but it's engaging the whole practice team so that if somebody happens to mention to the receptionist, and I know some people still have receptionists, my old practice is primary care. We've got care navigators or primary care advisory. So it's about changing that shift of language so that if somebody mentions to the receptionist, oh, my mum's lonely, my mum's never, she didn't speak to anybody, or she's struggling with her food, then that person can say, well, we've got a link worker. So it's just that whole education around alternatives to a GP. And I think that advert's a really good place to start, because we all know people say, oh, that receptionists are too nosy, they ask too much, but it's not. It's about so they can find you the right place for you to go. So I think that's something. A few of my link workers do the social media pages for their practice. And I know my old practice, we did a big publicity push pre-pandemic, so this was advertised on the television in the waiting room. It was also published on the bottom of prescriptions. Follow us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter. And we were advertising the local groups there. We could tell them, you know, food pantries, the over 60s social club, what was happening in the local library. So even if people aren't seeing that link worker, and our model is that anybody in the practice team can refer into them, it doesn't have to be a GP, but by building that awareness, it might be the kind of the worried well that see their doctor that they don't need that appointment, but by following on social media, they can see what's happening in their community. And they might be the ones that can just pick up the phone and take themselves along happily. But the ones that the link workers do, as Roseanne, she hit the nail on the head. It's about that. Those are the people that are so entrenched in their illness or their social issues that they're never going to pick up the phone by themselves. And they're certainly never going to be the new person that walks through the door at a community centre to join a group. But the link worker has that. Well, I know it's Mary that runs that group. There's about 40 people go, or it's half women, it's half men. The age group is over 50s, whatever. So every time every bit of knowledge they've got about that group, they're reducing the barrier. So you're setting the scene. That patient builds the picture of what this group then looks like. And it's like, well, if Alison says it's all right and Mary's nice and she's been 4 or 5 times, I'll give it a shot. And Alison's even going to come along. But so when they open the door and everybody turns around, there's somebody else that they're looking at with me. And that's where you get the buy-in. Having that chum. I'm all for my link workers chumming people along, because that's how you'll get that buy-in. And as Roseanne says, if it takes 2 times to go along to get somebody settled, then that's what it takes. And then you see that patient go off and it's almost like, well, I don't need you anymore. And that's the best result you can get.
Thanks. Emma.
Just a final question, and I will be short, and I'll aim it for Christiana. How can we raise awareness that link workers exist?
Thank you. And I think so on the last point, I was going to say that they are not glorified signposters. So there is a need to educate the public and to be aware of what support and services is available. This is where some form of directory, but the challenge has been who is keeping that up to date and things like that. Because there's a tendency where, you know, public health interventions sometimes may well increase inequalities if we're only catering for some. So the social prescribing link workers are for those that have got complex needs and those that cannot make those connections. So there is a need for signposting so that we don't overwhelm the social prescribing link workers, which then means that those that need support don't get the support that they need. In terms of how we raise that awareness, so I think firstly, we need to get political buy-in to raise that awareness. We need to have a national campaign that is there to help to raise that buy-in. We need to also have campaigns that embed and embraces social prescribing link workers' role as part of the team. So we're not longer saying, we're saying Team GB, Team General Practice. It's not just about the general practitioner anymore. So it's the language that we're using about how we're normalizing things and what education package do we have for both clinicians. Do we have champions? I mean, in some areas, they've got clinical champions for social prescribing. We need to have more clinicians that are actually championing this. because a GP is a place where you go to get connected to other professionals as well as services. It's not the focal point where you're reliant on just one person alone. So yes, at a national level, we need intervention from the government to help with that. We also need other professional bodies. Certainly, the Royal College of GPs Scotland needs to do more to raise the profile of social prescribing amongst their members. We've been doing some work with some professional bodies, doing podcasts, because there is training that is needed and awareness amongst all the professions. And then working with existing patient groups, for example, the National Association for Patient Participation, helping them to helping to raise that awareness, as well as the VCSE infrastructure organisations who have a role to help to raise the awareness as well.
Thank you. I'm aware that we have a lot of members wanting to ask questions. I'm going to move on to talking about health practitioners' uses of social prescribing. So if there's any points that our panellists wanted to make off the back of Emma's question, build them in by all means to further questions. I'm just really worried that we're going to run out of time. It's incredible to hear the enthusiasm that you all have for your area of expertise. Can I come to Sue Webber?
Thanks, convener. I've got a couple of questions. I'll give them individually. In the 2019, this committee did an inquiry and it highlighted a number of the barriers health practitioners and their use of prescribing in primary care. And such barriers included a lack of strong evidence for its long-term effectiveness, time constraints, awareness and quality assurance. So I was wondering, maybe Alison can start, has any progress been made in tackling these barriers over the past 3 years?
Alison.
Sorry, I missed a bit of that at the beginning. 2019.
I was asking about, in 2019, this committee, when we were taking evidence, it wasn't me, they heard a number of barriers that healthcare practitioners faced in terms of their use of social prescribing. And those barriers included the lack of strong evidence for its long-term effectiveness, time constraints, and also awareness and that quality assurance. In terms of, how can they be assured that there's that consistency of quality? And there's also, if you link into that, that continuous monitoring that those services are still there in the community, because we know that volatile is not the word, how transient some of these organisations may or may not be due to funding. So has any progress been made in tackling those sorts of barriers in the last 3 years?
I know that our programme network manager, Anne Crandles, was involved in previous committees giving evidence, and there was to be more meetings with the Scottish Government at that time, and then the pandemic came along. When you talk about evidence, all the Scottish Government ask from link worker programmes is for information on minimum core data, which is dates of birth, genders, postcodes, ethnicity, and the reasons for referral, and there's a few more. Our programme itself, every year since 2017, we've produced an annual review giving statistics of the number of referrals, the number of people that engaged, the gender split, the age split, especially the postcode splits, because that fits in with the health inequalities work. That gets broken down into practice. We send out stats every month on engagements, referrals, how many DNA rates, any funding applications, and we give them information on caseload. So that goes right across our network. I touched on earlier that we've got two GP advisors in our programme, and one previously did a bit of work on looking at a patient cohort group, their attendance rates the year before they were referred to a link worker and their attendance the year after they had seen a link worker, and there was a 30% drop in attendance. We've also seen by link workers being involved in doing a bit of signposting training for receptionists, that they were able to redirect 6% of requests to see a GP to other places. So this is what we're just doing ourselves. Professor Stuart Mercer of Edinburgh University, I'm sure he is. He's involved in looking at doing some more work. The fact that we've got this elemental programme coming on board, that should be able to give us more data that we can delve into, because I think we need to start showing our evidence. But also, we all know that the best evidence they can get is when they hear a patient, or the best thing you can hear is when a doctor says, I haven't seen Mr. Smith in 4 months. Where is he? Well, he's at a men's shed, or he's volunteering, or he's at the walking football. Claire and I hosted a session for the Scottish Government in September, and we had a patient speak about their own experience. And that's the best evidence you can get, is when you hear it from somebody that's living it.
Thank you, Alison. I suppose you've alluded a little bit to that as well. I think workers have reported that there is that lack of understanding of their role amongst, but I think nationally on that one, which does impede also the progress on social prescribing, and you've mentioned some of the successes there. So what progress has been made to raise awareness of their roles and make it more a much more viable route for care and support? And I suppose I'm also looking to ask around that point of contact, and I'm going to still say it's through the GP. It's through the GP practice, and a lot of the frustrations that we hear are from people who are struggling to get past the receptionist. So everyone is still having to come in to that GP practice to get that referral. So it was interesting when I heard from Claire earlier when she was speaking about some of the self-referral pathways. So I'm just wondering, what are we doing to increase the lack of understanding?
Claire did want to come in your earlier question, Sue, so if I can go to Claire.
Thank you.
Thanks. I think that there has been a change over the past few years, certainly in the evidence that we've been gathering. So for spring, we were the first to use the elemental software. So we've been using that for 3 years, and it's been really beneficial in capturing our evidence. So we measure the impact for people, for communities, for healthcare and for government. And I do have an external evaluation, which I'm more than happy to share around, because there's lots of evidence that we capture within that. And it's not just about the improvements for people, although that is incredibly important. It's about what difference are we making to GPs, to NHS? Are we reducing the pressures? And that's really why we were set up. And we have found evidence to say that we are doing that. So I can share that around so that you can have a look at that. And if there's any questions, please come back to me. I just also want to say about the work of the Scottish Social Prescribing Network. As our ambitious aim is that, could we not look at evaluation tools across the country? Could we not be capturing this evidence so that we prove social prescribing's work? We know it works within our individual services from the four members that are here today giving evidence, but how can we capture this across the country? So that's certainly an ambitious aim that we have as part of the network. What was the second question there, sorry, just about referral routes?
Because you mentioned earlier, Claire, about some self-referral stuff that had been going on, rather than everyone having to phone in to the GP sessions.
Yeah, and I think I touched on that before, is that the GP is a great place to go, but it's also a barrier for some people. Some people can't get an appointment for various different reasons, and some people are really scared to go into these healthcare settings. So that's why we changed our model, and it's to make it more accessible to people in the community. So we're doing that, you know, we're able to do that. Alison had touched on that before about the third sector is really proactive and able to adapt very, very quickly. And so we're ever changing the programme to suit the needs of the community. So we're open to different suggestions of different referral routes that we can take so that everyone gets the appropriate support going forward.
Bring in Christiana, and then we're going to have to move on to questions from Evelyn Tweed. Christiana.
Thank you. So I just wanted to touch briefly on the progress in terms of evidence. So at the moment, the National Institute for Health Research has funded a national evaluation that the University of Manchester is carrying out that is going to look at some programmes in Scotland as well as programmes around. So again, that will be helpful in terms of helping with the evidence base. Of course, that's going to be, I think, is a 3-year study or something like that. But again, it's just echoing what the colleagues have said, where we have a problem with people understanding what we do in the first place. And therefore, this is a role that is about the glue in the community and the NHS. So I just kind of like worry the evidence might be measuring the wrong things. This is about relationships. This is about integrating care and social prescribing. I mean, the patients say it makes them happy. So how can you quantify that as well? So it's just being very careful that we can't do a randomized control trial because there are various variables to be able to control. So that's not applicable for social prescribing research. So it's going to rely on that social care sort of like research. And before actually coming on here, when we had a roundtable, some of our members, they just felt, well, why do I constantly need to evidence that I'm doing a great work? I mean, some of the professionals don't have to do this as well. So there are kind of like, you know, are we measuring the right things in the first place? And moreover, some of the services and activities that we refer people onto, they're already evidence-based. We know the value that, you know, physical activity or eating well or being connected to your communities and all of that, the impact that it has. So what the social prescribing link workers are doing is being the person with the link to those and removing the barriers that people face as well. So the another challenge that we are getting is in terms of capacity. We need to increase capacity. Some of the social prescribing link workers, they are actually at capacity. So COVID has highlighted the need that people kind of like have or things that they've put, you know, they kind of like not seeking health interventions or support. So the, and also has highlighted to some clinicians in terms of the value that they bring to their community. So certainly, I mean, you know, we need to get ambitious. If this is made something that we're going to mainstream, we need to get ambitious with the numbers. We definitely need to increase capacity. We need to protect this workforce. So we can't have a cycle where we keep overrunning, kind of like new things come on and then we don't have plans to expand it. And then the workers kind of like get burnt out. Nobody's looking at their career progression, educational needs, and all of that. And then it becomes unattractive as well. So it's something we need to think about. How are we increasing capacity as well? And the pandemic has not actually helped in terms of progress, you know, in terms of evaluation and stuff, because the role has changed for some social prescribing link workers. Everybody has had to sort of like adapt as well. But now is, what is the remobilization plan for social prescribing in Scotland? How are we going to recharge communities? It's now the community groups and what they're able to provide is limited. How are we going to make sure that we have increased number of people that are going to be listening to the patients and asking them what matters to them and saying, how are you? Because at the moment, when people don't feel listened to or get heard, that's a very big problem. Yes, they need to get heard first before then saying there is no appointment available. So how do we do that? And how do we increase resource that means that they don't actually have to ring through the GP in the first place? I mean, we can't manufacture any more GPs, or we can't, it takes a long time to train other members of clinicians. So what we've got at the moment is community. It is the non-clinical roles and the community assets that can help us. And I think we can deploy that immediately.
Thank you. And you've led very nicely onto our next theme on community organisations. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. To what extent does the third sector have capacity to deliver more socially prescribed activities? And I'd maybe like to direct that to Alison first, and if anyone else wants to come in.
I think the third sector has been massively impacted by the pandemic. You know, everything shut down right away, and they're only slowly coming back out of that now. I think we've touched on a couple of issues already, that the third sector have the ability to be very responsive to needs and can respond almost anything that's asked of them, but they need properly resourced. As somebody mentioned earlier, social prescribing is only as good as the resources you can prescribe to. So that's the biggest challenge that we face. And we've Concern Network really set up in 2017. We've said that part of the link workers' role is to highlight gaps in services and also highlight the ones that work very well. We've had a couple of success stories of joint funds and applications for self-management courses, so that they've not had to rely on waiting for funding coming down the statutory routes. But those are few and far between, and they're always short-lived, and that's what we don't want. Things have to be sustainable for the future. So whilst all the link workers do a great job, they do create extra demand on the third sector. So there really has to be the investment into that. And I think I've mentioned earlier, what would be ideal is getting primary care involved in those funding decisions so that it really does firm up that collaborative working and acknowledges the good work that the third sector can do by supporting state services.
Dan?
Thank you. Yeah, I think that similar to Alison saying there around especially with the pandemic, a lot of third sector organisations, they changed and adapted to what they could deliver. And speaking for within Glasgow, a lot of local organisations, small local organisations, really stepped up where other services weren't available and really took hold and supported communities. And I think it's quite sad as we move forward that a lot of those organisations now aren't being funded, and so we're going to be losing them. And that really saddens me that a lot of our links workers then won't have these valuable resources to be linking in with. We're really fortunate, again, that we've been able to do some collaborative work with other third sector organisations, looking at funding bids, supporting funding streams, but also as well, for some organisations, we've looked at getting spaces within some of the health centres, so maybe more national organisations that are further afield. We've supported them to come in and offer services within health centres so that individuals don't have to travel to other parts of not just even the city, but you know, I think of one organisation, the Moira Anderson Foundation, that we've linked in with because we have had a number of individuals with childhood sexual abuse and requiring support and services. To travel to Airdrie for a lot of people was really out with their comfort zone, out with their, you know, financial capability. So for us to be able to support those services to now be able to offer on the doorstep within Glasgow have been invaluable. I think there was a piece of research done, and it is going back quite a bit. I think it was 2015. And it was Catherine Skivington at Glasgow University. She did a piece of research around the impact on third sector, and that was primarily around when the Glasgow service was a pilot. And she looked at what impact that was having on third sector by having these links workers now referring in. One of the things that they did find was, yes, there was an increase in referrals coming from links workers, but also it was the appropriateness of the referrals. So in the long term, it took them less time because previously they would have had referrals that would have been inappropriate, and they would have had to have worked through that process and realised that at that point that referral wasn't appropriate. Whereas now, although they were getting more referrals, they were actually appropriate referrals. So there was time being more ably spent with actual individuals rather than having to re-refer someone back or try and link them in with another service. So I think we really need to look at, moving forward, we need to be looking at funding streams for our third sector, and maybe not calling them third sector because they're not third, they're just as important as any of the other statutory sectors. So we need to be giving them that same place at the table.
Good point. I know that Claire wants to come in, and then Evelyn, if you have a supplementary question, if you can direct it to someone. I'm looking at the clock. We've still got some members wanting to come in and other themes. Claire, can I come to you?
Yeah, just quickly, so I'm not going to cover all ground from what Alison and Roseanne said, but I absolutely agree with both their comments. As part of Spring, to try and alleviate the capacity that these organisations face, we built in a capacity fund so that if there's lots of people being referred for different services, that they would have that fund to cushion that blow so they could put on more activities and groups. And the other thing I wanted to comment on is about a solution that the organisation I work for, Scottish Community for Health and Wellbeing, we've written a blueprint for a healthier Scotland, and that talks about the capacity, and it also offers a solution for this issue that we have. But I don't have enough time to go into that today, but I will send it around the group so that you can comment on that and maybe get back to me. But it's definitely a solution that's there for Scottish Government.
Thank you. Evelyn?
Thanks, Convener. To what extent is a lack of reliable, up-to-date local information about services hampering the ability of health practitioners to use social prescribing? And I'll maybe direct that to Roseanne.
Thank you. Yeah, I think that that's something that's really important. LINCS practitioners, LINCS workers, navigators, community connectors, they all need to know what's going on within their areas. What we did within Glasgow at the start of the pandemic was within each of our clusters that we were based, we didn't have LINCS workers in every GP practice within that cluster, but we realised that we could have a resource and support all of those practices. And what we did was we allocated a particular LINCS worker for each cluster to every, at the start of the pandemic when we went into lockdown, they every week would look at what the resources, and they would take time out of their working week to look at and link in with these organisations and ensure information was up to date. Now, that is a real time constraint for LINCS workers who are based in practice, have benchmarks of referrals that they need to achieve. So we really do need to look at how we can have much more robust links with what services are available. And some of that responsibility then also goes to these organisations to be ensuring that they keep up to date. I know that within the Alliance, we have the ALICE programme, and I know that the next session that one of my colleagues is going to be speaking at that. Across the country, there are different directories, but these all take time. And if it's a digital directory, that may be great for some individuals, but again, there's a completely different theme is around digital exclusion. You know, we've not even touched on that yet, but you know, we want to be making sure that resources are available for everyone to be able to access. So it's about how we get that message across and keep on board of what changes there are taking place with services and service delivery.
Yeah, I think the digital exclusion aspect might be touched on by my colleague Paul Kane later on in the session. Can I have a quick supplementary question from Stephanie Callaghan? I'm aware that Christiana wants to come in on that theme, but in the interest of time, I'm going to get Stephanie's question into the mix as well before I come to you, Christiana.
Thanks very much, Convener. And it's actually just picking up on some of what was said there by Roseanne too, and I was going to direct it at Christiana. I think both might want to comment there. Just around the ALICE database, I'm wondering how widely is it actually being used, and is it the right system? Should we be really investing in it and ramping that up, or should we be looking at does something kind of local work a bit better? Thank you.
Christiana.
Thank you. So I think when we were preparing for sort of like this evidence session, I met with some of our members in Scotland, and you know, a few of them were not using ALICE. And they said it didn't fit within their locality because the needs kind of like different and what is available. So they did still have their own local sort of like directory that they use. So I think there is a role for a national directory where people can go and find the information, but it won't take away the need to still have your own information database, because some of the groups that the link workers might find might be quite really small community groups, or that are not kind of like very formal, or you know, nobody just knows about, it's just a few people that know about them. So they still have that. The challenge is that we need to recognize that this is about social change. We need to fund the whole social prescribing service. So in some social prescribing services that are robust, they would have a project management officer, they would have somebody who is looking after their own internal directory of services, because this has been the same challenges that the GPs have always had, where who is keeping the directory of the signposting options as available. What we cannot then have is having the social prescribing link worker just taking responsibility for that, because again, we need to meet people's needs. Some people need information, signposting. Some actually need somebody that they haven't identified what they want to do in the first place. And then that's where they need the social prescribing link worker, or they need the barrier. So there is a need to empower people with where they go to reliable information, up to date, but then the social prescribing programs still have their own database. But then also going back to my point about this is being about reducing inequalities and social justice. Well, part of the role of the social prescribing link work and how they do that is by identifying gaps. they're actually identifying marginalized communities or communities that are at risk of marginalization and saying there isn't services that's available for these people. And the challenge has been, who is taking responsibility for that? That's not something you bring up at the MDT meeting. The MDT's focused on a different thing. And this is then how we begin to truly reduce inequalities, where we're having some groups that there's actually nothing for them. If you feed that to the infrastructure VCSE organizations, are they taking that on board? Also, the short-term funding, it kind of becomes a problem. Give you an example. I've got a working group that I actually attend. It's for women of color. And now, because it's volunteer-led, they're not sustainable. They're not putting up a lot of works. And, you know, and I'm feeling like, okay, there isn't. So this is a group that is a good case study that an infrastructure organization should be able to support to help them to be sustainable. And then that way we are actually doing that. So what is the role of the VCSE within this? Is their funding mechanism a hindrance and means that they're not very outward looking, are not, you know, able to capture those intelligence from the social prescriber link workers, or there is no mechanism to feed that back? Because I think this is about creative disruption. So everybody needs to wake up to the times that we are in. If you're a GP practice, you're VCSE, we all need to wake up to the times that we are in. So that means there is a bit of a creative destructive thinking to make sure that we are proactively meeting needs and we are evidence informed and not just duplicating the same service over and over again.
Alison wants to come in on this, and then we must move on to questions from Sandesh. Alison.
Just very briefly, the Scottish Community Link Worker Network that's been set up, that's a discussion that we've been having about the sources of information. Not a huge amount of authorities use ALICE, and they then spend money on setting up their own online resource. So in Edinburgh, we have the Red Book. We're having that linked up to the Elemental system, but I already know from my link workers that there's an iThrive directory, there's also a long-term conditions directory. So even within Edinburgh, there's four different directories that my link workers check, plus their local knowledge, plus social media. So that is an issue, and it is always a challenge to keep them up to date. I'm constantly asking my link workers to let us know about changes to the Red Book, but also, as Roseanne touched on there, there should be some responsibility on the local groups to keep that up to date as well, because these online resources, they're not just for the health inequalities, it's for anybody. We know through the increase of the link workers and PCIP surgeries that, you know, loneliness can affect anybody. So these resources need to be accessible for everybody, and we have touched on the digital exclusion, which was really highlighted at the start of the pandemic, but I know that that's going to be discussed on, so I'll leave that there. Thanks.
Thank you, Alison. Can I come to Sandesh Gohani?
Thank you, Convener. I just want to pick up on something that Alison Leach said right at the beginning of the session as to how much GPs like having link workers. As a working GP, I can tell you I love my link worker because they take a lot of work away from me. Social issues, navigating benefits. These are things I simply can't do. I don't have time to do. So I absolutely love the link worker. I've got two questions. One's about recruitment. The other is about retention. So my first question is that we were looking, the Scottish Government was looking to recruit 250 community link workers in GP surgeries by 2021. But there are areas like Aberdeenshire, Forth Valley, Midlothian, Highlands and Western Isles without any link workers. So what assessment have you made of the efforts that have been made, and how can we stop areas from falling further behind?
Well, maybe go back to Alison on that.
This is one of the challenges that the Scottish Community Link Worker have been tasked with. Scottish Government have funded Voluntary Health Scotland to run this. So there is a mapping exercise just now on tracking where these 250 link workers are. I think there was an article that said that there was 210. So Voluntary Health Scotland are working on it. There's a steering group with different representations on that, and I am on the working group. We're also looking at the training of link workers, and there's been two peer support sessions this month and last month to ask link workers what they would like for that. Sorry, I've forgotten what the second part of that question was.
So what can we do to stop other areas falling behind?
Well, we need to map what link workers are actually out there. and we plan to get information on what their programme is. It a health inequalities programme? Is it a general one? What's their evaluation? So we really need a mapping exercise of what that link worker programme looks like in Scotland. So then we can build on, you know, there's the commitment for 1,000 mental health link workers. There's the call, the Royal College of GPs put out their manifesto pledge last year looking for link workers to be placed in every surgery, but concentrating on those ones in areas of deprivation first of all. So we really need to see exactly what the scene is like in Scotland first of all, and then that would be complemented by the Scottish Social Prescribing Network that would map all the social prescribing programmes that are not funded through Scottish Government but are out there, such as Clare's programme, and to see what the overall social prescribing picture looks like in Scotland, and that would be our starting point.
Thank you. My second question is around retention. And I'm a bit concerned because there's a report in 2020 which suggested 1 in 3 link workers plan to resign within a year due to a lack of support and supervision. So my question is, to what extent do you think these problems are undermining the shift to social prescribing, and what we can do to reverse that?
If that's the National Association of Link Workers report, the response from Scotland was minimal to that report. But what has been highlighted through the establishment of the Scottish Community Link Worker Network is the huge differences in the programmes that are set up. We had a leads and managers meeting just the other week. And for example, Edinburgh, we're quite adamant that link workers should be paid a salary equivalent to a band 5 within the NHS. Every time our service level agreements are up for renewal, that gets tightened. Because we know as soon as, if somebody pays the lowest, as soon as a vacancy comes up, somebody will just jump the next where the highest pay is. But Dumfries and Galloway have told us that their link workers are only paid a band 3, and that's constantly getting squeezed. So their recruitment is, they find that really, really hard. Whereas in Edinburgh, we have hardly lost anybody other than moving, they've either moved away or they've gone back to studying or taking a career break. So we do not have a lot of turnover because we are really passionate that they are seen on a level with the multidisciplinary teams within practices. So we are then looking at the additional things that we can do through training, through CPD, what are the things that we can help professionalise. And that's why we've really encouraged our link workers to take part in the Scottish network peer support session, so that collaboratively all these link workers across the country have a voice that can then influence at government level.
Can I bring in Christiana before I come to Gillian Mackay? I've got a question on this. Christiana.
Yeah, so I think that without a doubt, there is a problem around quality, safety and retention. We also did a survey when we were trying to explore the prospect of a professional register. This was led by England, but we used that opportunity to consult with our members across the UK, and over 70%, you know, called for a register. And the reason why they wanted to be regulated was because of the challenges that they were having in terms of not seen as professionals, and the pay issues they were getting, lack of training, lack of educational opportunities, and also sustainability of the role as well. So, and then we also did an annual survey as well, and we had examples from Scotland where they said they are resigning. Because they felt like the other colleagues within the same area they're working, they are on another pay band. So there's something around inequality here amongst the social prescribing link worker workforce. How can we be expected to be helping reduce inequalities and social injustice when they're feeling that in the first place? And I don't think that this is anything that is just specific to social prescribing link workers. Other professions face this. So when you've got a profession that is only setting up its identity, so of course it's at risk of all of these things. We are developing an education standards, which we're going to launch in May. So again, we're having conversations with Wales, I think after the school, as well as with education, NHS Education Scotland and things like that. You need to have something that says this is what these people do, and these are the level of requirements or experience and knowledge you need to have. So yes, you can come in as an expert. Expertise is not professionalism. professionalism is the way you carry out the role, and that is the concern that we have. It's where you're rolling out something at scale and you're using taxpayers' money to do that. But even though you leave the experience of doing this, you need to be protected and do this as a professional role and not just a hobby. What that means, it then means that we are not get away from the postcode lottery. So there is a big challenge where we need to standardize the pay. We need to make sure they're getting the correct education that they needed and the training. This is a national issue, it's a global issue. There is a global social prescribing alliance as well. So it's very important that we are paying attention to the ethics of the role. We're paying attention to the professional standards. So yes, it's not regulated, but we need to have some baseline. Yes, you've got a link worker in this area and a link worker in that area, and everyone has got different levels of experience and expertise. Well, the patients just know that it's still a link worker. So you need to sort out whether this person has got the right level as well. But this is the reason why we've got the National Association of Link Workers, and whilst we are working with bodies that are concerned with the education and workforce development so that we have a workforce strategy. What we would like to see is what is the workforce strategy for social prescribing link workers in Scotland. That strategy should take into account how we grow the workforce, because at the moment, because we don't have the standards, people want to become social prescribing link worker. How do you become a link worker? It then means we are indirectly excluding people, we're not having apprenticeships, we're not having traineeships, and we're not maximising the opportunity that it brings. Whilst people are then within the role, they're not then clear in terms of where are they moving on to, which by having those standards and mechanisms, it means that people can move on to other clinical and non-clinical role around the system. So we have created a profession, but then it doesn't have everything that it needs, and particularly in Scotland, is really, really lacking. Other nations are stepping up to the mark and having a support offer for their social prescribing link workers, and at the moment, it's lacking.
Okay, thank you. Gillian.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Social prescribing covers a wide range of activities and organisations, as we've heard from all of you this morning. Do community link workers have time and capacity to engage with all aspects of social prescribing? Is there a risk that they're being asked to help people with an ever-expanding range of issues, from mental ill health to financial concerns and many of the other things that you've all detailed this morning, without any increased capacity and support? And could I maybe go to Claire first?
Thank you. Claire?
Yeah, I think they do have capacity. Certainly with my social prescribers, they wouldn't do all of that. So they, for example, if it's money worries or financial issues, they would support the person to engage in services that do that professionally. So, for example, Citizen Advice Bureau, Money Matters. So they would physically support that person to get to the right access. So it's not about the social prescriber doing everything. It's about making sure that they get the right professional support that they require.
Is there anyone else like to come in on that, or are we content to move on?
Alison.
Yeah, I would just say, if anything, right now my link workers are seeing huge demand on welfare rights. So it's about the services that are around to support the link workers to do their job effectively. Just because of the increase in demand, the health and wellbeing fund, the money that came out. Link workers have had a say in that, and we're hoping that that is directed into the areas that will help support the link workers refer people onto. And I think just about their capacity, link workers just have an ability to be incredibly flexible, meet the needs, but also to enforce their boundaries and know where they can be effective and when they can't, or we do more harm to the patient or to themselves, because we do have to look after our link workers as well.
And can I bring in Rosanna?
Thanks very much. I think that that there has been, that capacity building for links workers, but especially over COVID within mental health services, we've seen a lot more links workers having to hold patients, if you like, because the services aren't there, statutory services or long waiting lists. And people are coming back to their GP practices because referrals are being made, but they've been told 6-9 months waiting list for some trauma services. For one individual in Glasgow, it was 27 months from the initial referral before a service was actually put in place for someone. Now, these individuals have to have somewhere to go, and they do come back to their GP practice. GPs do look at their links workers at being able to support these individuals. We're looking at other creative ways on how we can do that. And with that could be some locality approaches where, you know, a few links workers will come together and maybe look at setting up a conversation cafe where not all of them have to be available there, but they can take it in a rota basis. And so the individuals that are waiting for services to become available for them, they have somewhere where they can go so that they still feel listened to, they still feel that they're being supported. And I think that's really important, especially as we start to come out of this pandemic. There's just going to be even more of a tsunami regarding mental health and wellbeing services and individuals needing support. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. So we've extended our session by about 10 minutes because we do want to give a good airing to inequalities aspect. The question is led by Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I think a lot of our answers this morning and our discussion has been peppered, I think, by some of the barriers that exist in terms of accessing the sorts of pathways that I think are there and the sorts of interventions. I suppose I'm interested in the views about the potential for the exacerbation of inequality. So something Roseanne was talking about in terms of that the need for support, you know, for someone to perhaps be accompanied to certain activities and to have that intervention there. But also the Alliance in their written evidence had spoken about some of the challenges with, for example, passes for sports and leisure activities. So I suppose what I'm interested in is, you know, if someone has never had the support to learn to swim, for example, and then are given a 6-week leisure pass that ends after 6 weeks, you know, is that actually increasing the barriers? Because that person then feels like, well, you know, that didn't actually help me in a way. And I suppose related to that, after that 6-week period, is it the financial barrier too high in terms of being able to continue with some of these activities? So sorry, I appreciate that was quite a lot, but I don't know if Roseanne maybe wants to start because it was some of the Alliance's evidence that I had drawn some of that from.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks very much for that. I think that is one of the big barriers that we face when we are linking into other resources, is we have to look whether there will be financial exclusion for individuals. We do try as much as we can to ensure that services we're accessing will either have a set fee or they'll look at an individual's financial status around accessing, especially around some particular counselling services. I'm thinking, for example, around anger management. I know that there's a service that we would link into within Glasgow who will have a flat fee, but through discussions with our programme and talking about those referral pathways, they now have an opportunity for people to pay what they can afford as well. So it's about looking at where we can, where services are able to accommodate that. The Glasgow Access for Leisure Facilities, you know, that's great that GPs and links workers can access for 6 weeks for a patient to get access to all these services. But as you say, at the end of that 6 weeks, £15 a month is a lot of money for someone. Do they not have food for that week, or do they go and take on this gym membership? And that's even before then we're looking at individuals that wouldn't have recourse to public funds. Where can we highlight for individuals? So what we will look at is we'll look at a lot of organisations or assets within our communities that are going to be free. And that's what we try and link in with, because we are very mindful that even something, you know, some people might think £15 isn't a lot of money, but for a lot of individuals that we're working with, £15 is, you know, a lottery win. And we need to be mindful of that. There's a lot of great resources in the communities within which we work. And that opportunity for people to link in with is really important. In Glasgow, we've also, the HSCP have for practices, some practice development money. And what some of our GP practices have also done with some of that practice development is use some of that funding to buy pantry vouchers. because again, for individuals accessing food banks, there can be stigma for some people that they don't want to access the food bank. Being able to go to a food pantry where they have more choice, and we can highlight and be able to give over that voucher so they don't even need to have that £2.50. That's really increasing. We've noticed anecdotally increasing people's self-worth, and you know, and you can't put a price on that. And all that was a £2.50 voucher to go to a food pantry. So I think we really need to look at our community assets. We really need to look at how we're funding our community assets, and we need to make sure resources are available in these localities and neighbourhoods that really do need it. Thank you.
Okay. Alison and Christiana want to come in. Can I take Alison first?
Thank you. I think that example of swimming is a very good one. We have there's a Healthy Active Minds programme in Edinburgh that people get, they go on a programme and then they get access to leisure for £1 a time, but that's only for a year, and then you can't be re-referred to that. So all the good that you can do by having somebody access sports facilities then disappears after a year. And we don't know what their own situations are, whether they could get into work, so that would be sustainable. This is where I would like to see an overarching social prescribing framework, so that all this can be fed back in, so it can influence the bigger strategies such as public health. You know, at the beginning of the pandemic, the UK government launched an obesity strategy because of the people who were ending up in intensive care. There was initiatives there about get your bike fixed, get out, get moving. But all this could be, even the sports strategy. So if you have a collective voice through social prescribing that feeds back these challenges to keep people well, that obviously impacts the wider population, then by having that overarching social prescribing structure within Scottish Government, I would like to see the link workers and social prescribers be able to influence change at government level, so that we didn't find these people falling off a cliff after so long, because then you just send them back to the issues that they came to you with in the first place.
Thank you. Christiana.
I think we would like to see who is benefiting from social prescribing. So break that down by various demographic data, because what is beginning to highlight is that we actually need more diversity in terms of the social prescribing workforce themselves. So it's very important that we are looking at who's benefiting from social prescribing in the first place. And I also think that as a society, if this is about social injustice and inequalities, well, we need to be prepared to actually fund to help people, because some of the people that will be vulnerable and benefiting from social prescribing may not initially have the means to do that. Whereas there are some that with support, they actually are able to, you know, find the means. So let's just be very careful about what social injustice can do. It can stereotype people and by default it silences their voices. So it's about those that need help, they should be able to get help, and it should be free. Those that are actually able to then move on, they should be able to do that and not being put into one category. Oh, this is the asylum person, or oh, this is the BME, or this is the disabled person. They can also get work. They can also have startup businesses. They can also set up social enterprises. People have got aspirations, and I really see us, how are we supporting people's aspirations? And those that are not capable or not able to in society, how do we actually help them?
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you. Those were very helpful responses. I think something that I think I picked up there is we do want to try and avoid, I think, any sense that this would appear paternalistic or that there would be a sense that things have been done to people. I think it's very much from what you said this morning about that, you know, collaboration essentially between link worker and patient. I wonder if I can just come back to Roseanne briefly just on that point about we talked about the pathway, if you like, into sport. I mean, is there any kind of work being done to look at how, you know, people perhaps have an initial block of training or support to access sport, for example, and then are encouraged or supported to actually join a local club that is free? Because I'm thinking a lot of the barriers very often are about, you know, having the confidence to join a club that's free and get involved in things. And I wonder if there's a sense of being able to kind of train someone and support someone to do that and then to access the free clubs that already exist in our communities. So just keen to understand how common that is.
Roseanne?
I think, again, it varies, you know, across areas. I know of where there's been football sessions, and so we've linked in, and that's been around accessing football fans and training, or, you know, looking at walking football for specific individuals. We've also been involved with some pieces of work around some sports that people may see as being elitist, such as tennis, and a great initiative within the Drumchapel area of Glasgow, where we've worked with individuals and encouraged them to become involved, and they've started by having some free lessons, but then also they have they can join the club within that neighbourhood, and it is free to come along. The equipment that they require is then made available as well. But I think it is quite few and far between. You know, a lot of the groups that we'll link in with are things that you don't need equipment for, really. So, like, a lot of walking groups will take place, and they can be things that are free and taking people about. We were really fortunate. We got some funding from Paths for All, so we're able to then bring walking groups together and do celebration events every year and take people to different areas, you know, such as the Kelpies one year. So it's about opening up opportunities for individuals, but I think there is still a lot of work to be done, especially within the sports sector, around tackling inequalities, because a lot of sports just aren't available or inclusive for a lot of the individuals that we would work with alongside.
And I'll give the last word to Alison, and then I'll need to round off the session. Alison.
Just very quickly, we have quite a lot of activities here that are free and accessible, walking groups, walking football, street soccer, different things. But sadly, one of the things Link Workers reports is that people don't have the equipment, whether it's a pair of decent walking shoes or a waterproof jacket. So the Link Workers then have to find funds to get these basics. And even for the few asylum seekers that I can think of that have no recourse to public funds, they would really struggle to engage in any kind of sports activities just because of the minimal income that they have. So that's something that the Link Workers are very conscious of.
Thank you. I want to thank the four of you for your evidence this morning. It has been very, very interesting and very helpful to us. We are going to have to round this session off. We're going to have a 10-minute break, and we'll come back with our second panel. Thank you. We move on to our next panel, our second panel of witnesses given evidence this morning as part of our inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. And this panel will examine the role of technology in alternative pathways to primary care. Welcome to the committee. We've got four panellists this morning. Scott Henderson, the Head of Programme for Digital Front Door of Technology-Enabled Care. Chris Mackey, Digital Hub and ALICE Programme Manager for the Health and Social Care Alliance. Dr. Paul Perry, the Associate Medical Director of NHS 24. And Adam Satura, the Head of Policy and Communications for Age Scotland. So welcome to you all. Your ears will have been burning throughout all of our sessions because this has come up throughout all of our sessions and our inquiry. And I guess I want to ask you all, first of all, ground you all about patients and public awareness of the digital services that are out there in terms of whether you think people find them useful, people understand what's out there, and whether you think that maybe gives patients, people of Scotland, increased capacity over managing their own healthcare. I think it will depend on the demographic, obviously. I don't want to preempt what you're going to say, but I'm really interested to know your thoughts. And can I come to Scott Henderson, first of all?
Hey, good morning, and thank you for inviting me to give evidence today. To your questions, I think that in general, I think that there is good awareness about some services and not so much awareness about others. I think that reflects the nature of the development of services. We have things that are more mature than others. In terms of understanding those services, again, I think that for simple services, there's good understanding. For more complex services, then more support is required. And being able to give greater capacity over managing one's own health care. I think that there is some evidence that suggests that this is helpful, and I think that that it's quite encouraging, some of the evidence that we have seen over the years, as this is an area that has been in development, I guess, for quite some time and is now starting to show maturity.
Thank you. And can I come to Chris Mackey?
Yes, good morning. I think that what we're seeing is that the development of digital health and social care technologies is really benefiting some people, but we do risk widening the inequalities in Scotland, because there is a real risk, and I think we're seeing that some people are being left behind. And I think that one of the things that I would urge is that we consider human rights principles when developing such innovations, that innovation is good and progress is good. There's no question of that, but it's a question of not leaving people behind. At the Alliance, we've worked with Scottish Care and Vox Scotland on some human rights principles for digital health and social care. And we're keen to see these embedded within Scottish Government approaches to digital health and care, which will promote, of course, alternative pathways. So just quickly, I'm going to run through those human rights principles. People at the centre. So in other words, we don't put technology at the centre, we put people at the centre. Digital where it's best suited. And that means that sometimes digital isn't the best solution. Digital is an ongoing choice, so people can choose and should be able to choose not to use digital solutions, but they can also opt into them, and that should be a meaningful choice. In other words, it comes on to the fourth principle, which is around digital inclusion, which is about ensuring that people have the skills, confidence to use digital solutions. And also promoting workforce development and ensuring that workforce is equipped to use those tools. And finally, access and control of digital data, which is something that we're seeing and we're talking about in terms of the Scottish Government's approaches to the consultation around the data strategy at present. So So I think that what we're seeing is that their digital approaches are good, but they're not for everyone, and they shouldn't be applicable to every scenario. So it's important to consider inequalities. It's important to consider human rights principles when developing such solutions.
Thank you, Chris. Can I come to Paul Perry?
Thank you, convener. Yes, so I'm just to introduce myself to start with. I'm the Associate Medical Director here at NHS 24. Should also disclose I'm also a GP that works in the out-of-hour service in NHS Lothian. But for the remit today, I'll be giving evidence on behalf of NHS 24. NHS 24 is Scotland's national provider of telephone and digital services, and we work with partners and stakeholders to provide information access to urgent in-hours and out-of-hours care for the people in Scotland. I think coming to your question about awareness, NHS 24 currently provides alternative pathways to primary care, particularly with that digital angle to it. We commissioned a progressive piece of market research back in 2016 that looked at, I suppose, public's awareness of this trust and the NHS 24 brand. This was updated again back during the pandemic in 2020, and essentially showed there was a very high awareness of the help and advice provided by NHS 24 through those digital channels. Of those participants, 88% showed that there was a great benefit both in the in-hours and out-of-hours period through those services. And overall, there was an increased understanding of those NHS 24 digital services, particularly NHS Inform. NHS 24, we do provide those digital services. Good examples of those are the implementation of Scottish Dental Emergency Service, and we specifically used Near Me technologies to design, develop and implement that pathway during the pandemic. Another example is the use of social media. We provide annual winter campaigns as well, which we have just done in over the festive period recently. We also use social media as well and technologies to increase awareness of health related topics such as the menopause, as to what we've recently done as well. So I think in summary, I think NHS 24 are very mindful that there's still a lot of work to do in this area, and there needs to be further awareness of these alternative pathways, particularly the technology enabled care to tap into those aspects of primary care. Thank you, convener.
And Dr. Perry, just picking up on that, I mean, awareness is one thing, but also having choice. It's not for everyone, and that we do hear people, I mean, we hear that all our email inboxes, people, I've been fobbed off, I don't want to do this, I want to see someone face to face. Cognizant of that?
Yes, thank you, convener. Very cognizant of that. It's around offering choices for the public and patients and not removing those choices. And at NHS 24, we're very much patient-centred. We have a user-centred experience team that looks at user-centred design when we're designing, implementing services. We particularly sit centred around technology, particularly around that service development and delivery angle. When we look at NHS Inform and that platform, we've realised over the years that we need to design that platform that's used in different languages. Another example is the NHS 24 telephony 111 service, which we use Language Line on as well for people whose English is not the first language. So at NHS 24, we're very mindful of reducing these inequalities. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I come to Adam Statura?
Thank you very much, convener, and to the committee. There's absolutely no doubt that over the last 2 years, people have been far more aware of the digital services and digital access to these medical services than ever before, and largely because for many it was the only way to access them. And I think for many, many people, it has been very good, and for a great number of people, it perhaps hasn't been, because they haven't had the access to a device, the internet, to and been able to navigate a whole new system. So I think there have been considerable challenges for people there. And if we're looking on Age Scotland's behalf, not Luddite in any way, But for older people, where, you know, about 500,000 over 60s in Scotland don't use the internet, 600,000 over 60s don't have internet on a smartphone, there's a huge number of people here who sort of will miss out. And that kind of, for many people, the first port of call may be their G practice website, but it's a bit of a mixed bag in terms of how these things look and their accessibility and how to navigate through them. So look, challenges galore for people, but we do know that there have been very good strides made in terms of how to access services digitally, and a lot of people have found them very, very helpful indeed.
Thank you. I want to pick up on something that Chris Mackey said, particularly around human rights. We heard last week from Jess Sussman, who's policy lead of the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland, and she pointed to the fact that a lot of the patients that her members see have very acute mental ill health conditions. And for a lot of them, that doing things digitally was just effectively cancelling out their access to healthcare, because most of them would not do that. So, I mean, where do we stand in terms of just making sure that there is a spread of availability of services that is right for the individual?
Yes, I think that what we need to be doing is, as has just been said, we don't need to be closing any doors. We shouldn't be closing any doors. What we need to be doing is opening up complementary approaches to ensure that those that don't have devices, don't have data, don't have the skills and confidence can still access health and social care services. But at the same time, we need to take advantage of the innovations and the advances that we have. You know, we've seen great benefits from the Near Me platform, and what we need to be doing is offering that as a complementary approach, so that people don't feel that they've been fobbed off, and that people still have the ability to access services in the way that they feel comfortable. So I think that you know, it's about not throwing the baby out with the bathwater, really. That we should make progress, and we should exploit technological advances, but equally bearing in mind that we have a diverse population, we have an aging population, and we have lots of factors that will key in to whether people can use digital options, and lots of people won't or can't use those digital options. So let's not close down those avenues.
Thanks. Thank you. I'm going to move on to some questions from Gillian Mackay. Gillian.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. In their submission to the committee, NHS 24 highlighted that in stressful moments when people are feeling unwell or in pain, figuring out what is available can be a new pressure, which often results in them reverting to using traditional access points such as general practice or A&E. This suggests we need proactive communication so people are already aware of what's there before it reaches that stressful point. How successful has proactive messaging been, and what more needs to be done to ensure people are fully aware of where they should go when they need unscheduled care? And could I maybe go to Dr. Perry first, please?
Yes, thank you, convener. In terms of that proactive messaging, NHS 24 does undergo national communications campaigns. Good examples of that would be the redesign of urgent care pathway that was implemented back in December 2020, and the dental pathway as well that we set up during the pandemic as well. We are very active on social media in terms of signposting the public and patients to the right care in the right place at the right time, and are very, very mindful of doing that in the best way that we can. Thank you, convener.
As we've picked up on earlier, not everyone has access to the internet and electronic devices that will allow them to quickly visit NHS Inform, for example. And over the course of the pandemic, we've seen some reactive and quick changes to capacity and where people should receive care. How do we communicate changes to care, to how care should be accessed to people experiencing digital exclusion? And could I maybe go to Scott Henderson, please?
Scott, over to you.
Could you repeat that question, please? I'm not sure I fully heard it.
Of course. As we've picked up on already, not everyone has access to the internet or to electronic devices that allow them to quickly access NHS Inform. And as we've seen over the pandemic, places where people receive care have had to change quickly and at short notice. How do we communicate changes to people who maybe are digitally excluded? And how their care should be accessed?
That's a really good question. We've been relying through the pandemic on the Connecting Scotland programme to facilitate access to devices and to upskilling where that's required as well. There's still a significant programme of work to be done through Connecting Scotland, and certainly any programmes that I've been involved with seek to work alongside Connecting Scotland to ensure that that access is made available. So I don't think I can speak for NHS Inform on this one.
Maybe go to Dr. Perry again on that.
Yes, thank you, convener. In terms of communicating, I suppose, the care to the public and to patients, we are at NHS 24 very mindful of particularly those digital inequalities and public health inequalities, and reducing those barriers as best that we can as a nation. I suppose alongside the digital channels and services that we provide, we also offer that telephony 111 line as well, which would go some way to offering a reduction in that barrier to patients that don't have access to those digital channels and services that we provide. Our user-centred experience team are very well equipped in terms of looking at service development and delivery of those services with the patient in mind, particularly those ones that don't have access to those digital services and channels, apps and mobile devices and Wi-Fi and broadband as well. So we're very mindful in terms of the public that don't have access to these digital ways of accessing care, and that forms very much a part of the service development and delivery of those services. Thank you, Convener.
And from the Age Scotland perspective, Adam, over to you.
It's a very good question, and I think the answer to this is, well, you sort of go where the people are then. You know, we've had leaflet drops nationwide looking at this itself. The hope then would be people will keep these booklets in their own home to understand how a pharmacy or community pharmacy can help them more than they'd ever imagined, and perhaps why their GP might not be the first place to go. So we're looking at, you know, leaflet drops on a regular basis that people keep, because also people move and they lose things, TV adverts, radio adverts, these types of things, but also in medical settings. That, you know, once people have been there, that they are able to, you know, take material away to have as that good and quick reference. But I think one of the challenges here is also that across Scotland, depending on where you live, you might have fewer options with regard to where you go for this. You know, your GP or your hospital might be the only place that you can go with a reasonable distance to access sort of medical treatment, or if you're unwell anyway. So there might not be these other pathways that exist in rural, remote island Scotland anyway.
That's great, thanks.
Thank you. Paul, can I come to you on digital exclusion in particular?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I can perhaps follow on from the kind of path that colleagues were going down there around digital exclusion. We've heard some evidence from patient groups, particularly the Riverside Participation Group from Musselburgh, who noted that approximately 10% of the population doesn't have access to, or indeed have the skill required to use new forms of technology. And very often those patients are most likely to have the greatest health needs. So what else can we do in terms of protecting their rights, if you like, to access primary healthcare? I don't know who wants to take that first. Chris, possibly?
Yes, thanks for that. It's a very good question. I think that, yes, that, you know, I spoke about human rights earlier, and I think that you know, we know that some people don't have access to technology. They don't have devices, they don't have data, they don't have the skills or confidence. And so in some cases, as I said, it's about keeping options open for those people. In some cases, it's about providing the devices and the data. And Connecting Scotland has made great strides in that. But it's also perhaps about thinking about, well, who can help? You know, we've seen through Connecting Scotland, digital champions have come to the fore as well. And I think it might also be about the consideration of maybe something like a digital advocate, a person who can use those digital tools on behalf of another person. Now, that could be a family carer, or it could be somebody, you know, a social contact. But I think that there are such benefits available and now coming on stream through the use of digital health and social care, that there are ways that people could use those and make and have benefit from them without actually having to use them themselves in person. So I think that it's about considering other options, whether it's a support worker, whether it's you know, somebody who's known and trusted by the individual to use those avenues. But even if they don't have the device, even if they don't have the skills and confidence, that they can still benefit, because there are significant benefits that we can see through the use of these digital technologies. Thanks.
And Scott Henderson wants to come in on this.
Thank you. Yes. I guess from a Scottish Government policy perspective, digital services are very much being seen as additional to, rather than instead of, traditional services. And it's about providing an opportunity for those that are willing and able to access services in a different way to support them to do so. Within that, as Chris has quite rightly referred to, the Connecting Scotland programme does support those who want to access in that way but don't have either the means or the skills to do so, to acquire those so that they can access in that way. And I guess there's some pretty good evidence to suggest that that's a really worthwhile investment to make, because studies that have been done, it certainly shows that there's been a reduction in people just turning up at services because they don't have any other option. I think we need to be very mindful that everything that we design and everything that we bring into service from this point forward needs to be mindful that it's not replacing something, it's there to supplement or to complement something. Thank you.
Paul?
Thank you. Perhaps just to explore some of that further, I think Chris's point was interesting around who can support and advise. You know, I'm very keen on what we can do in our libraries, for example, in Scotland, and I had raised this point with Citizen Advice Scotland. They talked about some of their services, although I'm not sure that there is fully universal coverage on those services. So, you know, I think there is opportunity to do more there. And I don't know if the panel has reflections on that. I don't know if, certainly if Adam, you know, people that you interact with through Age UK are interacting in terms of kind of library services.
So, look, we know how important library services and community centres are. And, you know, the last 2 years demonstrated, as I said before, things, the doors have been closed, and as they reopen and need to reopen, these can become very valuable places for services to be hosted, number one, but also for people to get the information that they require. But there's also, look, there's also a whole bunch of phone services that exist as well. You might not always want to interact with the NHS, but you know, Age Scotland has a national helpline, or advisors can help, you know, direct, refer, signpost people to how to get access to the services that they might need. As well, often we hear from people who just haven't been able to get to them in the first place. I think going back slightly earlier to one of your points, Paul, about what more you can kind of do is, I think the kind of those services who you're interacting with that the starting position from them is that there may be people, and maybe quite a lot of people, who just won't be able to go online or do it over the telephone. And how do we make sure that our doors are just open in general? We can direct people to a digital service if that's appropriate. But, you know, I think this has been a big challenge, as doors have been closed, and trying to, especially in NHS settings over the last 2 years, is kind of almost keep as many people as we can who don't need to be in, desperately need to be in, away. And I think that's certainly come through loud and clear, despite not obviously GPs and health professionals want to see anyone who presents himself, but there has been that underlying protect the NHS so we'll stay away. And when we surveyed 3,500 over 50s at this point last year, there was certainly a core theme through that people didn't think that they were able to go and access their services yet. Now, the challenge here is the longer people are going without the medical treatment that they require or think they need, sort of further poorer health that they may experience, and the challenge becomes further exacerbated.
And can I bring in Paul Penny?
Thank you, Convener. I suppose I just wanted to build on those points, really. Reducing those barriers and inequalities around digital and health inequalities, it is really around offering choice more than removing those choices. NHS 24 was commissioned to do a piece of market user research there at the beginning of last year around particularly digital access, and the learning points that were gained from that was particularly around the health access piece. The public essentially wanted more information which was tailored to their condition, and as a clinician myself, I know that each patient that I see is different to the next patient that I would see in my waiting room. Each public member also wanted a different journey, which again was tailored to their own condition. And patient journeys are often, I suppose, multi-factorial, multi-touch points. You know, they might start off as a face-to-face consultation, but they also might have a digital element to it and other elements in factored in as well. And the main thing that is factored into, I suppose, design of healthcare like this are factors like experience, age, comorbidities and accessibility, which is very important as well. Thank you, Kunin.
Thank you. And Chris wanted to come back in.
Yes, thanks for that. It was just to come back about libraries and just what a fantastic resource that they are in Scotland. And I think we need to do more to build on that. There's a recent report, an action plan, which is entitled A Collective Force for Health and Wellbeing. And it recognises the role of libraries within communities. And I think we are at a junction point with libraries that, yes, they're a place for books, but there's also so much more going on within libraries, and we need to talk about it and we need to promote it. And also the fact that within libraries there are staff who are skilled in using digital tools, who can signpost to the resources that are out there for digital health and social care. So whether it's libraries or community centres, or whether we look at more mobile options where geography is challenging, then I think that we need to be looking at these kind of community-based type resources and options for support for people to access health and social care through alternative means. And I think, as I say, I think we're at a crossroads with libraries, and I really hope that we can see them as the absolutely excellent resource that they are, and because the alternative is, you know, use them or lose them, and we're seeing that in some communities where there's threats of closure. So it really would be for me to endorse libraries and resources like that as being highly valuable within communities.
Thank you. And Scott Henderson wants to come back in.
Thank you. Yes, I agree with my fellow panel members that community-based resources like libraries are very important and do need to be considered continually as to their role. They're not necessarily a panacea, though. For example, you may not want to do your video consultation in the library, because you wouldn't necessarily get the privacy to do that. But there are other services that would be more appropriate to access through that route. I guess my main point here is that we need to be understanding the access problems and inclusivity problems almost on a service-by-service basis, and to make sure that we're building in whatever measures that we can at that level to make sure that all those who wish to can access services. Thank you.
Okay. Paul, you have a final question, and I'll bring in Emma Harper.
Yeah, just specifically, I think, on NHS 24 in terms of telephony service, and I've raised this at committee before, but I think we have seen an exacerbated demand for that service because people want to have that contact via the phone. That has led, obviously, to the pressure, meaning that sometimes calls are unanswered, which is obviously, you know, none of us would want to see that. And I suppose my question is, what more do we need to do to kind of bolster and support the service? I don't know if Dr. Perry feels that's about capacity in terms of staffing, both call handling and clinical, or what else needs to be done there?
Yes, thank you, convener. So the question was on the telephony service in terms of how we can bolster up the service and meet the needs of the patients. Is that what I heard?
Yes, sorry. I was referring, Dr. Perry, to some of the challenges that I think have existed over the winter period with perhaps calls going unanswered. And I think the importance of how do we ensure that doesn't happen and that we have, you know, solutions in place to deal with the pressures.
Yes, thank you. I suppose the answer to that question is around, you know, us increasing capacity within our workforce, which is what we've done. We've recently opened the Dundee Contact Centre in December last year, which will increase the capacity within our workforce to be able to deal with that volume of calls. Last year, we dealt with 1.6 million calls to that telephony line, which was, I think, roughly 10 to 15% higher than the previous year. So we've definitely seen an increased demand over that time. We are coming out of a COVID-19 pandemic, which again has increased demand, not just on the NHS 24 services, but I think whole system-wide. But we are very mindful to be able to increase that capacity within our own workforce. But I think we need to take a stand back from this and actually see it systems-wide. So it's not just NHS 24, but how the whole system deals with the demand going forward. I think, particularly from an in-hours and out-of-hours primary care perspective, secondary care perspective, and then, you know, how we can work with partners and stakeholders in the third sector and voluntary sector as well.
Thank you. Emma, you have a question on this?
Yep, thanks, convener. Just a wee quick sup. I know that when we're talking about library services, and Chris Mackey said, use them or lose them, Perth introduced dog-friendly Fridays in their libraries, and that was in 2018, and Edinburgh introduced dog-friendly Thursdays, October 2019, to tackle isolation and loneliness, and so that folk didn't have to tie their dog up outside the library or leave their dog in the car. And is that something that you're aware of? And if so, is it something that we're tracking to see if dog-friendly Fridays in libraries is a good thing?
This is Emma's attempt to get dog-friendly Tuesdays in the committee, which I'm fully supportive of. would anyone like to come in? I saw a few of our panellists nodding. I saw Scott Henderson nodding along.
Am I unmuted? OK. I have no awareness of any plans around tracking or monitoring these sorts of services for libraries. It sounds intriguing. Would be very interested to learn more.
Emma, I think you've made your case.
That's right.
So we'll move on to talk about health literacy. Sue Webber. Sue.
Yes, thanks, convener. Hopefully you can see me this time. The signal's a bit more stable. The Royal College of Nursing has rightly pointed out that those who are health literacy are less able to identify or label what's wrong with them and are therefore less able to identify and self-refer the various alternative pathways that we hear so much about. What is your assessment of the risk that an increase in the use of digital pathways could increase the actual health inequalities that we faced or many face? And I know, Adam, you've mentioned earlier on in terms of the scale of the issue, in terms of even the number of over 60s not having a device. And also, Chris, you mentioned that digital should always be an ongoing choice and a meaningful choice. So maybe either one of you might be interested in responding to that.
I'll bring in Adam first. Adam?
Thanks for the question. It's a very good one. It's something that we do hear of quite a lot through our helpline, where people are actually trying to articulate, or have been the last 2 years, what is wrong with them. They're not really sure, actually. But if you consider the fact that, you know, people over the age of 70 on average are living with kind of three chronic health conditions, and the older you get, there's lots of different things you could be living with. You're sometimes not really sure what the issue is and where you go. You might just want to go to your GP, whether that's that traditional view of something that you would do, but also other things that can be picked up on when there, whether it's malnutrition, which we know is a real difficulty amongst older people, kind of people being malnourished, loneliness, isolation that actually could be an underlying cause for ill health, the mental health challenges with older people who often don't identify that these are things which they may have. I think it's very difficult that people just won't know where to go for each of these things. So if it's just one thing, it might be more straightforward, but trying to articulate that, particularly if, you know, English isn't your first language, you just don't know what's causing your, you know, the ill health that you're having, that can, just trying to find out and navigate the web to do so. And also remember, if you're living with some of these conditions, actually getting access and using digital devices is going to be pretty hard if you're arthritic, if you have Parkinson's, if you've got sight loss, and you're probably not wanting to ask somebody else to go and help you do all these things because it's your own kind of medical conditions that you might not want to disclose to other people and just ask for help from friends or family. I don't think that really works in this sense. If we're going to be, you know, a lot of people are quite private about this and not want to disclose just the extent upon which they might not be well. I certainly know that from older people in my life too, that that's not something that they're really wanting to tell you the full story, and quite rightly, because it's a personal thing.
And I think it was Chris that Sue identified as...
Yes, that's me. Yes.
Chris?
Yes, absolutely. We need to tackle health literacy. And I know the committee this morning have heard about link workers and social prescribers. And I think that that's a really good way that we can address such issues. But we need to expand those programmes. We need to see more link workers, more social prescribers, who can help people to articulate what is going on with them. And I think that it's about normalising these kind of approaches and expanding them into different settings so that people don't feel that they're getting a special service or one that's we've seen in Glasgow the Alliance's link worker programme initially targeted deep end GP practices, and I think that was the right approach. But it's important that these types of offerings are made more normal, with, you know, quotes around the word normal, of course. But so that people feel that this is just something that you do, this is something that you can access, and so that they're not feeling like they've got something that's special or cost driven or is in some way some kind of second rate service. I think the evidence that the committee heard this morning would underline the value of these types of approaches, but we need to expand them into different settings to ensure that they can help people with their health literacy. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue.
Convener, can I ask? Yes, thanks, Convener. In 2017, the Scottish Government published a health literacy action plan. That was like 5 years ago now, and that was from 2017 to 2025. So in those 5 years, what progress has really been made in improving health literacy? What sense do you get that there has been that improvement? And do you think the plan is contributing to the progress? Again, I'm not sure if maybe Chris is able to he's the man that
Chris.
I
thought. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm not familiar with that report. I mean, I think that what we need to be doing is and perhaps the report does this, but what we need to do is drill down into the different communities and sections of the population who are experiencing the biggest inequalities and drill down into those and make sure that, those communities are able to access the sorts of supports that can improve their health literacy, and that we look at that across the board in terms of the sort of intersections of different inequalities, including things like poverty, including things like unpaid carers, and those that are traditionally not recognised when we look at inequalities.
Thank you. Sue, am I able to move on to the next theme?
It looks like there's a couple of people that might want to be able to respond to that. Scott and Paul, I'm not sure.
I'll bring in Scott. Sorry, we lost our connection to the chat here. We're having some difficulties, so I'll bring in Scott.
Thank you. On the first point about perhaps making worse the health literacy, or at least the inequalities, expanding the gap by using digital services, because I think that there's a valid point in there, in that what we have seen is that those who engage with digital health and care services do increase their health literacy. So by definition, those that are not accessing can be at a disadvantage. I don't think that the answer to that is necessarily finding more digital ways to increase health literacy. I think it's about finding other ways that are more direct to help improve health literacy. You made reference to to the action plan on that. I'm not familiar with that work specifically, but I think that the suggestions around using link workers and key workers and others in the community to be able to support that in a focused way would be more likely to be an effective means of addressing that gap. Thank you.
I'll just check. Was it Paul? Did you have something you wanted to say on this?
Yes, thank you, convener.
Thank you.
There's a very famous piece of medical research and evidence that dates back 50 years, published by Julian Tudor Hart, which essentially looked at the health inequalities. And essentially that looked at and described those that needed healthcare the most were least likely to receive it. And there's things that we can do to improve that and to narrow that gap, such things as reduce variation within healthcare service provision and improve the quality of those services as well, particularly around tackling the need for the patients, increasing the supply and improving that quality. And I think, this conversation we're having today is around technology, digital, but specifically data. We can look at data to really help drill down and do a deeper dive and understanding to which groups within the population are either over or underrepresented in different parts of the NHS service that we can help the most.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions around digital health and care information from Emma Harper? Emma.
Yep, thanks, convener. I am interested in how we are communicating what services are out there, and I have raised questions around the ALICE system in previous evidence sessions, and we've heard this morning about an Edinburgh equivalent called Red Book, and there's one in Dumfries and Galloway called DG Locator. And there's a mental health one called Spring in the Borders. So I'm interested in how are we communicating to wider people that can direct care? How are we helping people understand that there is a system called ALICE? That's pretty much my first question.
Yeah.
Anna, that would be
we should
to
probably
Chris.
Go to Chris yeah. first on this, since we've mentioned ALICE. Chris?
Yes, it's in my job title, so I should be able to answer this one. I mean, I think I joined the Alliance about a year ago, managing the ALICE programme, and what struck me was that there was so many great things about ALICE, but that in a lot of cases communication wasn't quite there in terms of promoting ALICE as a resource for people to find information about health and wellbeing, because it is a national resource that maps community assets right across the country. And it brings people many routes into improving their health and wellbeing. It's a crowdsourced information resource, which brings with it a number of challenges, but in my view, that's the way to do this kind of work. And, you know, I've had conversations with Scottish Government and with a variety of stakeholders, and people say, well, if we didn't have Alice, we'd have to invent it. And I think that one of the things is that, you know, what we're seeing with Alice is that it's been around for 12 years and it's gone through a number of incarnations, and we are at the Alliance, we're seeking to continually improve that. But the problem, you know, one of the challenges is that, you know, everyone's got a directory. You know, even if it's just like a spreadsheet on your desktop, you've got contacts that you know and trust. And it's about encouraging people to invest in Alice as a national resource. Now, you know, I heard this morning about EVOC in Edinburgh and their Red Book resource. We also heard about a number of other different resources that are out there. And one of the pieces of work that I'm keen to do at this point in time with Alice is to form partnerships with those that do have these local directories, and to look at aggregating their data into Alice, because as a national resource, there are a number of benefits from a public health, from a kind of policy perspective. We can see what resources are out there, but we can also empower citizens a bit better locally. So a good example of that would be the fact that, you know, I live in Bishopriggs, which is in Eastern Bartonshire, but I'm on the border of Glasgow. So with Alice, I can see community assets that are just nearby, regardless of whether they're in the Glasgow area or whether they're in the Eastern Bartonshire area. And there'll be countless examples like that. And I think that we can work together with the different local information providers to aggregate in to Alice and to improve the resource that we have there. And because, you know, as much as this is about, you know, looking at the technology side of things, and with that requires investment. So capital investment is required into Alice. But it's also about the people aspect of it and promoting this resource that we have, and to basically say, well, let's work in partnership. Let's say, okay, well, we have a national resource. Let's improve that as best we can, but let's also respect the work that's been done locally with those local directories, so that we can have an improvement on Alice and the offering that is given there, but also, you know, doesn't discredit or take away anything from what's been done locally. And I think, you know, as I say, the Alice system, you know, it requires investment from a financial perspective, but it also requires investment from a political side of things. And I think what I would urge from the committee's perspective is to push the government, the Scottish Government, into saying, well, you know, let's promote that, because the awareness isn't what it should be. The communication hasn't been, and the government have funded Alice for the past 12 years, and I think that it's about saying, well, let's capitalise on that, because we have a fantastic resource of community assets, and the approaches that it takes are all the right ones in my view.
Emma,
and I'm not saying that because it's in my job title. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Emma. Thanks, Chris. Just to come back at you then, did the use of Alice increase during the pandemic when we were going through the first lockdown phase? Were people using it more? And also, are we tracking? Alliance has shown that Alice usage has increased, and in 2021 it showed that. So I'm wondering if COVID had an impact on the use of Alice. And then also, who's using it? Are we tracking whether it's link workers, whether it's other people that are? Because last week, Optometry Scotland and Community Pharmacy Scotland hadn't heard of Alice, but they also spend a lot of time with patients, sometimes up to half an hour if you're doing somebody's eye examination. So basically, who's using it?
Oh yeah, thank you. Just to come back regarding the numbers, I think you've seen in our submission that increase in 2021, and I think what we saw in with 2020 was that there was expectations were lowered with lockdown. We were in a full lockdown for a good period then, and went back in again towards the end of 2020 and into 2021. So when things opened up, we saw more usage of ALICE. And hopefully we can build on that. And one of the other things that I'm looking at the moment is increasing the number of access points. So not just ALICE.org, but partnerships such as the one that we have with NHS 24, where we have ALICE data surfaced on NHS Inform. But we've also seen a new partnership with, for example, the Glasgow Alliance to End Homelessness. Mm-hmm. They have a Get Help Glasgow resource on their website, and they bring ALICE data into that. And so one of my tasks is to forge new partnerships like that. We're talking to people in a variety of aspects, including the social prescribing technologies, to bring ALICE data in there. So just specifically to answer the question about who's using ALICE, we can see that we have a sizable proportion of people are coming through Google searches or other search engines, which are out there, of course. But we're also seeing usage directly from ALICE.org, and we can surmise that yes, citizens are using ALICE, but there's maybe about half of their usage, I would say, in estimating that are either professionals or they're searching on behalf of others. So it's important that we make the ALICE resource fit for purpose across a range of devices, mobiles, tablets, of course, desktops, would traditionally be more professional users. And also we've done quite a big piece of work around accessibility to ensure people affected by sensory loss, first of all, can access ALICE and will be able to use it as best as we can make it. We're fighting on a number of fronts to ensure that ALICE is fit for every citizen. And that's the aspiration, is that it's not just for some people, it's for everyone.
Okay, thank you. Can I bring in Sandesh Gulhani?
Thank you, convener. Just Chris, I think you said that ALICE has been around for 12 years, and you also went on to say that the communication is not what it should be. As a GP, I'd never heard of ALICE. No GP I know has ever heard of ALICE. Organisations giving evidence to us have not heard of ALICE. It's not that the comms aren't what they should be. The comms are non-existent. After 12 years, I would expect a very good data source to be something that people use and know about. So my question to you is this actually value for money, or should we be looking to maybe use this money for something else?
Chris?
Well, I think that what we're looking at is communications need to be made on a number of fronts. And I think that from an Alliance perspective, the resource that we have is spread quite thinly, and we have a small team working on ALICE. But I think that also it's about, as I've said, some of that responsibility coming to Scottish Government and partners in the NHS and others to say, well, this resource exists. I would say that the ethos of ALICE is the correct one. I would say that the technology that sits behind it is the correct one, but it needs investment. And if you're saying that communications have been non-existent, then what we need to do is invest in those communications. That's the issue that I would say.
David Torrance's questions.
Yeah, thanks, convener. It's just a quick question. In my one of my local areas, the manager, who's one of the manager leads of all the GP practices, he knows about ALICE, and so his GP practices know about ALICE, but they said it might not be as up to date as what it should be. So certainly I'm aware of some general practitioners that know about ALICE. But I think Dr. Gulhani's point about not knowing any GPs that don't have access is probably quite important. So that's just a point about, I guess, raising awareness and linking to make it work better. Because, for instance, the DG Locator, which is third sector D&G run, they are working on collaborating and with the GP practices to direct more to ALICE and other services as well. So I suppose that would be the thing, is like, what do we need in order to make ALICE work better, apart from just money?
I'll come back to Chris. But again, this is, I mean, our inquiry throws up these points. They're all well made. And of course, we put them to the Scottish Government as well. So this is all very worthwhile. Chris?
Yes. I think that it is a constant issue that comes up with ALICE and any information resource of this nature. All those local directories you spoke of will face the same issues about keeping things up to date. Now, one of the things, as I said, about the ethos of ALICE, about crowdsourcing information, it depends on people keeping things up to date. Now, what I'm hoping to do, using the resource that we've got, is to alter focus slightly and to address that data quality issue specifically. And because I know that people will go to ALICE and they will look at information and they'll say, oh, well, that wasn't updated recently. So what confidence can I have in it? Well, I think that what we need to do is continue with the crowdsourcing approach, but also redirecting some of our attention into specifically addressing that data quality issue, and we've got some plans for addressing that with staff time, but we've also got some plans around the technological aspect and giving people reminders to keep things up to date, and that we can do through automatic means on the platform itself. So I think that not a day goes by without that quality issue being raised, and I think that it's something that, from an ALICE perspective, we need to look at. But also, if we're looking to local solutions to aggregate as well, that we also need to be mindful that those directories need to be up to date. So it's it's a constant battle. You know, if anyone's done any work in this sort of area, then you'll know that as soon as you publish something, as soon as you write something like this, they go out of date. So the job is never finished.
Yeah. And can I bring in Scott Henderson before we move on? Scott.
Thank you. I think there's a couple of really interesting points in there. I think the data set through ALICE is really a really important one, and it's never, ever going to be perfect because of the nature in which of what it's providing information on, because these groups change quite frequently often. I think that the other point around certainly about GPs' awareness of it, I think, is an interesting one, simply because I'm not sure that GPs have been a target audience for ALICE, certainly not 12 years ago. And we're now in a situation where there's much greater interest in social prescribing, though there may well be a case to be made for having more promotion to GP practices of ALICE as a service. And I guess the other thing is that we need to be thinking about this as a service that needs to evolve. And we know that post-COVID, the world is a different place. And we need to think very carefully about which services that the public are going to want and when they're going to want them and what format they're going to need them in. So I think those are just some additional points for the committee to consider. Thank you.
Thank you. And Sandesh, you wanted to come in again.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Scott, you said GPs were not a target for ALICE, with about up to 60% of the things that GPs do being social, with link workers, with the new GP contract, all, and that was in 2018, so maybe not 12 years ago, but certainly from 2018 till now, I would say ALICE would have been a wonderful resource for GPs to know about. So my question to you is, why were GPs not a target? Because that, to me, seems nonsensical.
Scott?
I would love to be able to answer that directly. I cannot, because I've not been involved in the work to date. I think it's an interesting question, and we can certainly take that back. But my point earlier was that it maybe wasn't originally intended as or marketed to GPs. in that timescale. But I do see that there is definitely an opportunity for it to be more widely promoted now.
Yeah, and obviously this could form part of our recommendations, and this is the value of committee scrutiny, right, in action, I would say. Can we come on to questions from David Torrens?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everyone. From a health practitioner perspective, what are the advantages and disadvantages of remotely delivered health and care services? And to what extent do remotely delivered consultations and services ease pressure on GPs and GP surgeries? And I'll go to Dr. Paul Perry first.
Paul.
Thank you, Convener. So the question on, I suppose, remote delivery of healthcare services and the advantages and disadvantages of those. NHS 24 has been very much up the middle of remote delivery of those services. The use of Near Me rollout within our dental service last year was a good example of that. It allowed an increased number of consultations with patients who couldn't access dental care last year. With the design and development of any healthcare service, there are always advantages and disadvantages. We've touched a lot today on those inequalities, particularly on the public health inequality side and the digital inequality side. And NHS 24, we're very mindful of that, having the user-centred research team to interact with the public through public partnership forums to take their advice and guidance on those. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. David?
Online triage systems, how could they be improved, not only to give confidence to the patient, but to the practitioner to use them? And I'll go back to Dr. Paul Perry, please.
Thank you, Convener. So in terms of those online triage systems, you're right. These things have definitely increased since the pandemic in the last 2 years. Again, online triage through the use of Near Me with our dental service was one of a few of those services that we rolled out over the last year or so. There is ongoing work within NHS 24 to do a further scoping exercise to see what the possibility is of the use of online triage systems, particularly remote consultations and video consultations. We have the phase two of the redesign of urgent care that's going forward, particularly focusing on musculoskeletal. We are working in with partners and stakeholders on that going forward, and the use of video consultations is one example of many we will take forward and look to see how we can design and develop that with partners, with the public and our stakeholders going forward. Thank you.
Scott Henderson wants to come in on this. Oh, there's maybe been a wee bit of a time lag there. Scott, would you like to come in on this?
Yes, currently doing some work around online triage and GP practice through a programme called GP DAX. The evidence that we've gathered around this gives a very mixed set of messages. There are some general practices that absolutely love using these triage tools and believe that they are reducing workload in their practice and making excess demand more manageable on the one hand, and there are others who find that they are generating a lot more work, and there have even been reports of sort of staff well-being being affected by the use of these products, and not in a positive way. From a patient perspective, some of the advantages are that they can contact the practice out of hours and don't need to be joining that 8:30 a.m. telephone queue. Certainly the public engagement that we've done around this, which has been fairly limited, has shown that the public's generally quite positive, but it is conditional. They want to know more about who is looking at their request when it comes in, that sort of thing. I think more generally around the remote delivery of services, there are other benefits. So when we look at long-term condition management, there's a lot of work going on in that area. I can give as an example the scale-up blood pressure monitoring programme, where that's been shown very much to positively have an effect both on reducing the need for face-to-face appointments and improving convenience for patients, but it also shortens the time to diagnosis for things like hypertension. So there's, again, it's very very mixed in terms of the advantages and the disadvantages. I think being able to describe all of these as a single thing is a bit dangerous because each service has its own advantages and disadvantages, and it depends quite a lot on how they are designed and how they are delivered. Thank you.
Emma, you wanted to come in on this.
Yep, just a quick question for Scott. I'm aware that, like, during the pandemic, pulmonary rehab was starting to be delivered digitally, and so the evidence says that that does work, especially because these folk are vulnerable and they might not want to go to face-to-face appointments. And also, I know we do remote monitoring for chronic obstructive pulmonary disease as well, and I know this because I'm the co-convener of the Lung Health Cross-Party Group. We've done a lot of work around this. So just your thoughts around whether these remote monitoring ways and then the pulmonary rehab delivery is something that we could be looking at doing more widely, for instance.
Absolutely. This is interesting territory because we are changing the ways in which people are working. So there's quite a lot of work to be done around how you design new pathways around around each of these services. And there's quite a bit of variation between services across Scotland in the way that they wish to deliver their services and how they would want those redesigned pathways to be delivered with digital supports. But the Scale Up BP programme is a good example of having perhaps two or three different approaches then coming together and becoming much more of a national approach. And that's where we've seen the sort of the benefits start to really get realised at a national level. But there's lots of work to be done to make sure that we design these things properly and to make sure that that they are producing the benefits and that we're avoiding as many of the disbenefits as possible. But yes, absolutely, we need to continue to invest in this area and to accelerate where we can.
Thank you. Now I can want to talk about something that's come up an awful lot in our inquiry, and that's the concept of a single electronic patient record. Questions led by Sandesh Kohani.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, a single electronic patient record certainly has been coming up a lot, and a lot of organisations we spoke to spoke of the potential great benefits there would be from creating this. So my question would be, so I've got two questions. One would be to Dr. Paul Perry, if you could maybe talk a little bit about how useful that would be from an out-of-hours NHS 24 point of view. And then my question would be, what progress since December 2021 has been made towards creating this single electronic patient record?
Yes, thank you very much. So the first question was around that single patient record, and the latter question was around the progress that NHS Scotland has made on that during the pandemic. But to take your first question around the single patient record, yes, I mean, this, I think, you know, as a clinician myself, I think frustrations, I think, at times in terms of being able to see the whole patient record and that whole patient journey, whether it's as an out-of-hours GP or an NRS GP. At the moment, the NRS GP is able to produce something called a KISS summary, so key information summary, which allows that to be shared with some care providers in terms of giving a sample of the patient's medical conditions that they've been diagnosed with. There's the ECS as well, which allows a care provider to be able to see the medications that patient may be on. But unfortunately, at this moment in time, we're not able to see that whole record in terms of the day-to-day consultations that the patient might have with their in-house GP. At NHS 24, we use the SAP data system at the moment, and the out-of-hours services and territory boards use ADASTRA. So there is an element of data interoperability with that. So if I was a clinician working at NHS 24, I would be able to send down an electronic summary to the out-of-hours clinician in the territorial wards, and that would give a snapshot of that that patient record at that moment in time. But at this moment in time, unfortunately, we're not able to share that whole patient record and to see that. That there are lots of clinical systems that are out there in the NHS, but I think to overcome this barrier, we do need a central platform and a cloud-based platform. I am mindful and aware that there are conversations ongoing just now within NHS Scotland at looking at those and doing a scoping exercise around those opportunities. I think in terms of that patient record, we do need to overcome those barriers of the data interoperability, sharing that data so we increase the continuity of care for patients, which is the heart of this, and also reduce the need for patients to repeatedly tell their story to different clinicians and different care providers. Thank you.
Okay. Stephanie, you have some questions around this.
Yes. Yes, I'm turned on now. Sorry, my apologies. Just to come back on that wee bit, Chris, you actually just reiterated a lot of the points that I had written down here as well. And really interesting as well to know that work's actually going on already to look at a centralised cloud-based platform. Just for some clarity as well, at the last evidence session last week, we had pharmaceuticals were talking about the fact of being able to actually write up information in that and have access, as well as having access to information on it as well there. Is that something that's included in the pilots that are happening just now?
Come to Paul. I don't know if everyone heard me there. Again, about some gremlins in the system. Paul.
Yeah, thank you, convener. Again, the question was around, I suppose, that cloud-based platform and data sharing. So it is my understanding that there has been a data strategy engagement programme that has been set up, and there are various partners and stakeholders sitting around that table to look into this. There is other work ongoing at the moment with NSS and NHS Scotland around e-prescribing in terms of that pharmaceutical aspect. So getting away from this having to write a paper prescription to a digital prescription, and this work is currently ongoing. I don't know in terms of what the timelines are on that, in terms of it actually hitting the shop floor, but I do know that stakeholders and partners are working hard behind the scenes to get that up and running. Thank you.
Fantastic. Just to kind of follow up on that as well then, is it more about having a cloud-based system that all the different systems that have been used by different health professionals and beyond that as well into alternative pathways, is it more about all these connecting into one cloud platform now rather than actually having a kind of system that runs right the way through that's the same everywhere? Thanks.
Yes, thank you. I think that the best way of approaching this is probably to often take a stand back and to see it through the whole system lens in terms of, you know, what in hours and out of hours primary care our needs are to meet the needs of the patients, and the same with secondary care as well. I think in terms of options and opportunities, I think that's probably one of many, and I think that's definitely one that's being discussed at this moment in time.
Thank you. Scott would like to come in on this.
Yes, thank you. There is a data strategy for health and social care currently being developed. It will be publicly consulted quite widely. And I think the delivery date for that is late summer this year. I think there are some important points coming out here around a single patient record, but I think we need to be also mindful that it's health and social care record is probably the goal here, so that we're able to have truly integrated services. I know that that's part of the work that's been considered through that strategy development and also through the work of the National Digital Platform. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks to all our panellists this morning. You've raised some very interesting things for us to consider ahead of our session, particularly with the Cabinet Secretary next week, I believe. That's all for our second panel, and I'll thank you very much. We'll move on to our next item in the agenda.
The third item on our agenda is consideration of three related negative instruments, and they are National Assistance, Sums for Personal Requirements, Scotland Regulations 2022, National Assistance, Assessment of Resources, Amendment Scotland Regulations 2022, and National Assistance, Assessment of Resources, Amendment Scotland No. 2, Regulations 2022. Now, these instruments refer to annual changes in rates to charges for residential accommodation. The first instrument increases the value of personal expenses allowance in line with average earnings. That's an increase of 5.8%. The second instrument increases the value of savings credit disregard in line with average earnings, which is currently forecast at 5.8%, and increases the lower capital limit from £18,000 to £18,500 and the upper capital limit from £28,750 to £29,750 in line with CPI forecast at 3.1%. I hope everyone's following that. The third instrument is to disregard payments paid to individuals living in residential care from the Scottish Infected Blood Support Scheme and equivalent schemes enacted in other parts of the United Kingdom. Now, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instruments and they made no recommendations to us, and no motions to annul have been received in relation to these instruments. And I ask members if we've got any comments in relation to any of the three instruments. We don't. Therefore, I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to these negative instruments. Does any member disagree with this? Nope, we're in full agreement. Thank you very much. So at our next meeting on the 23rd of March, the committee will hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care as part of our inquiry into the alternative pathways into primary care. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.